Miami, Florida, one of the most popular vacation destinations in the world. But for the eight remaining playoff drivers in the NASCAR Cup Series, there's no vacation today with just two chances left to grab a seat in the Championship Four.
Welcome to the Championship Four.
We're racing for a championship. Let's go.
He knows that what he did was wrong.
But that wasn't intentional. I don't know what was.
Larson wanted to make a three-wide dive bomb. Never cleared me. Just a piss-poor move on his execution.
He had a reason to be mad, but his race wasn't over until he retaliated.
The driver really can make a difference at Homestead. It's got so many options. But in the end, you're going to need to execute, not make any mistakes.
Three more slots open in Phoenix. Welcome, everyone, to Countdown to Green, presented by Sonic. Time is running out for those still alive in the quest to be the 2022 Cup Series champion, as the road to Phoenix and Championship Sunday is now just 2 weeks away. While the playoffs will be the focus today, it's been another busy week with off-track news. The headline, Bubba Wallace suspended for this race after intentionally wrecking Kyle Larson last week at Las Vegas. Much more to come on that shortly. Miami is the middle race in the round of eight. Right now, below the cut line are William Byron, Chase Briscoe, Ryan Blaney, and Christopher Bell. Joey Logano advanced to the Championship Four with a win last week in Las Vegas. We'll talk live with Logano coming up shortly. Well, the Peacock Pit Box all the way at the front end of pit road. Pit stall number one is where we are located, along with our crew chief Steve Letarte and Kyle Petty. I'm Marty Snyder. Let's talk about the headline story, Kyle. Bubba Wallace suspended for this race after intentionally wrecking Kyle Larson last week. As we take a look at that and how it all happened last week, did NASCAR get this call right with a one race suspension?
Okay, I'll make this short, if not sweet. A lot of people think yes. A lot of people will give you an argument yes. My opinion is no. They should have suspended him for the rest of the year. First, we have this, the intentional wrecking of another car at such high speeds on such a dangerous racetrack. So that is the first thing. Second thing he did, he got out of the car and he walked for almost 50 seconds. He walked from his car to Kyle Larson's car, right in the middle of the racetrack with other cars going by him under caution. Then we have the physical confrontation right here. This is a penalty unto itself that NASCAR never addressed. Then when he leaves here, he's escorted away by a NASCAR official, and he physically pushes the NASCAR official away. Now, we don't need to get into what Denny has to say about the car, or that the driver that did drive the 45 car has shortened his career because of a head injury that he suffered in this car. So many things. There's so many layers to this onion that you have to unpeel. His interview is another piece of it. So I do not. I think they tried to send a message, and I applaud NASCAR for trying to send a message. And again, this is my opinion, just my opinion. But I think NASCAR tried to send a message, and they think they did. But they should have sent a stronger message and said, this will never be tolerated. Not sometimes, never be tolerated.
Well, I'm not quite as bullish as KP, thinking we need extra weeks. Am I okay with the suspension? Absolutely. 20 crew chiefs. Let me say that again. 20 crew chiefs have been suspended Cup Series this year. This is the first driver. I'm okay with a driver being suspended for his own action. I didn't need extra weeks like KP. I'm good with one, but I will say this. If there wasn't a suspension, I feel very confident there was going to be a monetary fine. Well, where did that go? I would have liked to see a monetary fine with a suspension. I don't think the suspension should clear what the penalty was going to be. I think they're stacking penalties. I'm okay with no points, much like I was with William Byron. I think this is more of a issue on the racetrack, not an illegal part type thing. So it's money and a suspension. I like where NASCAR is, but a fine would have been even better.
Let me just say, though, crew chiefs get 4 weeks. That takes you to the end of the year. End of conversation.
Tire changers and jack.
Yes, that's what I'm saying.
Well, for the record, we did invite Bubba Wallace to join the show today via Zoom. He declined that request. But, Kyle, midweek, Bubba did put out this apology. So what's your reaction to this apology?
So he did put out this. And I applaud Bubba and I applaud 2311 for putting this out. But in a world, and I'm cynical, so let's just go ahead and say that, in a world of social media where we post everything, silence sometimes says more than the words that are written. And we have heard nothing
from Bubba Wallace since this incident happened. We have heard nothing publicly until yesterday. Denny Hamlin finally spoke up, and kudos to Denny Hamlin for speaking up on behalf of 2311. But the silence from that camp has been deafening.
So, Steve, if this was your driver and you were Michael Jordan or you were Denny Hamlin, how would you have talked to your driver this week and treated this incident?
Well, I think let's talk about the incident, right? What is it? It's a driver losing his cool. It's an athlete losing his cool. Bubba's not the first to do it. Yep. He won't be the last to do it. But if I'm Michael Jordan, if I'm Denny Hamlin, this is the example of what every athlete is trying to avoid. Every athlete in every sport is trying to unlock this next level of mental fortitude, this mental focus. Bubba's owner, Michael Jordan, he is it. He is as clutch comes. In the biggest moments, with the most emotion, he performed at his best. So Bubba Wallace wants to continue to be a better race car driver. It's controlling your emotions. This time it was in anger. Next time it might be starting on the front row to win a race. It's that same emotional response in your mind. That would be the coaching if I'm MJ trying to get my driver to understand less emotion, better performance.
Great point. Well
said. And to clarify, the team did put out a release this week in a statement. So, you know, we will hopefully hear from Bubba Wallace next week when he's at the track in person at Martinsville. Quick note, John Hunter Nemechek will be in the 45 car today for Wallace. And in case you missed the incident with Wallace and Kyle Larson, here's how we called it live last week.
Big battle off of turn four here.
The and into the wall goes Bubba Wallace. Oh. And he comes back across the track, tags the five. They're both in the wall. The caution comes out.
Yeah, Larson's got him in a bad spot right there and gets him in the wall. Then they go down the front straightaway, and it just looks like to me Bubba hangs the left to retaliate. And I got a problem with that. You're going as fast as they're going, and you hang a guy in the right rear quarter panel, that is exceptionally dangerous. That's racing right there, Larson's fault for sure, but that right there is not acceptable. Takes out Christopher Bell. That's an exceptionally dangerous move.
The shot the five takes to the driver's door on the front straightaway is vicious. I mean, it's a hit.
Clearly messed up and got Bubba in the wall. That's on Larson, but a retaliation in the right rear quarter panel on a mile and a half racetrack, that is exceptionally dangerous.
Jeff Burton and Dale Earnhardt Jr. were on the call last week. So, Jeff, that was your instant reaction in the moment. Would love to get your reaction now. Is the one race suspension a strong enough message to the rest of the drivers?
Well, I would hope so, Marty. You know, missing a race for a driver is a big deal. It really is. When you're not in that race car, there's a lot of things that happen outside of the race car. You not being here, you're supposed to be a representative of your sponsors. You have fans that have come to be here to see you. That is a big deal. Now, this is what I'm going to say. If we see it again, then the penalty's not big enough. Because these types of penalties, I'm all good with having things consistent, but what I'm not good with is ever having a penalty go down. If you intentionally wreck somebody the way that happened, there should be a suspension. And then the next one, if somebody doesn't, should be a two-race suspension. At that point, drivers don't get it, then there should be a three-race suspension. Never go down on this penalty. Keep ratcheting it up.
As an owner, I've had drivers suspended races for this exact same thing. I've had them fined. But I've seen some things this year that have been inconsistent. I've seen some drivers retaliate. I don't care about the speed of the track, the size of the track. Retaliation, you're trying to change the mentality going forward for not cup drivers. They know better. We're talking about truck drivers, Xfinity drivers, have these same sort of penalties. I was surprised. Hey, I own Noah's car, and I was surprised that he wasn't set out a race.
Well, I think that having this penalty on this level should send a signal to everybody. I agree with you. I thought Noah would have been fine if they should have suspended him. I'd have been okay with that. But because they didn't, I'm not okay with them not suspending Bubba, because I, again, think you have to keep ratcheting these things up. If you don't understand that you can't hook a guy on purpose, listen, racing's racing, but hooking a guy on purpose on the front straightaway in front of a bunch of traffic, we can't deal with it. We cannot tolerate it, cannot be tolerated. And this series right here sets the example for all racing in this country. Short track racers, everybody watches this. If we're gonna allow it here, then they're gonna allow it on a Saturday night. Should not be at any part of racing.
Yeah, we'll have to watch, because we know, Marty, that retaliation is part of racing. It will happen again.
Sure.
How will NASCAR react?
Very good points by both of you guys. Hey, when we return, we're going right back to Burton and Junior to hear from the first driver with a spot in the Championship Four. Former Cup champ Joey Logano will join us next as we get things started on a beautiful day here in Miami. For the first time, NASCAR fans can view every lap of a NASCAR Cup Series race from inside the cockpit of any car they choose. Live in-car camera streams for the entire field are available for free as a part of NASCAR Drive. Visit NASCAR.com/drive or download the NASCAR mobile app.
Tony Stewart wins it. Three-time champion. Matt Kenseth, Kurt Busch. California's Kevin Harvick does it.
Make room, Richard Petty and Dale Earnhardt.
Yes! Oh, my God!
A lot of it was for her. A lot of it was for me.
You are the man. You are the man when it comes down to it.
So many fun memories from Miami. The champion was decided forever here. And this place still has those last day of school vibes, doesn't it?
Yeah, when you pull in here, you can tell it's all closing in. It's the end of the season. And when you look at the playoff standings, right, other than Joey Logano, I'm not sure the story changed for many. We got a few feeling better, a few feeling worse.
Yep.
Nobody eliminated. Still a lot on the line.
Well, you mentioned it as former champ. Joey Logano knows all too well the pressures of the NASCAR Cup Series playoffs. But oddly enough, the only one not feeling the pressure today because he's already advanced to the Championship Four with a win last week, and right now hanging out with Junior and Burton at the front of the grid.
Yeah, we're going to talk about that. Thanks for coming down here, Joey. We saw the emotion when you got out of the car at Vegas, how glad you were that you were locked in. You get to go and run today and at Martinsville without any pressure. I mean, talk about that. Where does that rank in relief, in elation, in all the things you've accomplished in this sport?
It's great for like 2 hours, if I'm being honest with you. It's nice to know you're in it, but then you're like, okay, well, let's not waste this opportunity. This is the advantage we got in the next 2 weeks, is to think about Phoenix before our competition really gets to. And let's make sure we take advantage of that opportunity we earned by winning at Vegas. So you've been in this position before. It definitely is an advantage to have that. And you have a couple races where, you know, you can kind of recharge your batteries a little bit. This race, yeah, we want to win it, but we can also take advantage of being a little bit more aggressive with strategy. We can be more aggressive with our car setup, things that we wouldn't typically try. We earned that advantage to kind of go away and do that.
So we constantly hear from the drivers how much fun this racetrack is. We love calling the race here. Why is it so much fun for you guys?
It's hard. I think that's why it's so much fun. It's challenging. It's very wide. You can run different lanes. Restarts are chaos out there on what lane you want to be in. The choose rule is one part that's tricky, but even just as you go through the first 2 to 3 laps, what lane you need to be in. And then as the run goes, you're going to see cars migrate to the wall and then running really, really close. The closer you get to it, the faster you go. The closer you get to it, the more likely you are to hit it. So it's a challenging thing, but with the next-gen car, it seems like you can get away with it in the wall a little bit more often. And with our ability to take more risks, I'm going to try to be a little more aggressive at that today.
So we talk about and we hear from drivers like you, talk, you know, being able to look forward to Phoenix. What are the things that you are doing that you obviously or otherwise would not be doing that these other drivers can't to prepare for Phoenix early?
Well, I mean, you only have a certain amount of time in the day, but you just change your focus a little bit from being at Miami and Martinsville to more time focused at Phoenix, right? You start looking at films earlier. You start going over strategy stuff earlier and just start striking those conversations sooner while there's just less distractions, right? And especially, you know, if you win your way in at Martinsville or you point your way in at Martinsville, there's so many other things you gotta do.
That's an awesome airplane.
I had to fly over a few minutes early, but
it was great.
Cool either way.
It's gonna be great. But hey, it really gives you the time to think about a lot of things sooner.
Pretty cool to be able to have the fly over here, but I got something for you. Where is the book? I got a book around here somewhere. Here it is. All right. I know you got a couple kids. All right.
I've read this book already.
Really?
Yes, you sent me one.
Oh, I did.
Absolutely.
Well,
My son
I know you
it.
Have multiple kids. We're going to give you an extra copy here. This is Buster's Trip to Victory Lane.
Very cool.
Yeah,
thank you.
Hey,
you enjoyed reading it. Yes.
Don't tell me the ending. I don't want you to spoil it.
I don't want to tell you the ending. It's a good story. It's good for kids. It's actually a good story. These guys are top gunning us here.
Wow.
Tom Cruise is up there right now.
Yeah, that's pretty awesome.
That's incredible.
Awesome, man. Well, hope you have a great time today. Kim.
Thank you.
Kim, hey, where are you at, Kim? You see these planes flying over?
I know, they're causing chaos down here. So loud, but very cool. Caught up with Ross Chastain, who's been taking all the pictures. I know you have a lot of family here in what is your hometown race, at least home track. But in terms of what we're going to see here today, you have been the best driver on intermediate tracks this season in terms of laps led and points earned. How hard will it be to replicate that type of performance here at Homestead, Miami?
Yeah, it's going to be tough, Kim, but First, I want to start off with our track house family. We lost somebody recently, and so we are we're racing for somebody and with heavy hearts today to lose one of our own. But you know, the only thing we can do is go forward and go race today. And yeah, it's going to be tough. There's no right way to do it, right? There's no perfect way to get through these cup races. So, yeah, for our Kubota Chevy, you know, if we run the wall, there's going to be a lot of learning today for how much these cars can take. We saw yesterday cutting right rears down, not from the body, but just from rubbing on the wall, I think. And at the test, we were up there scraping it all day long. So there's a lot to learn for these next-gen cars, and I think Trackhouse is ready to learn, right? That's all we want is a chance to learn.
As we've gone through the second half of the season, a lot of people have noticed that we're not seeing you, at least it doesn't seem like, as aggressive as you were the first part of the season. Do you feel like that's a fair assessment, and are we going to see the wick turned up?
I definitely think it's fair. I mean, I'm human, so I evolve and I continue to learn. If I was the same driver I was in March today, I wouldn't be doing myself a favor, and I wouldn't be here if I didn't continue to learn. So I'm going to continue to learn from my heroes out here on track and try to beat them, right? And for everybody that's supported this team this year, that's what they've given me the tools to do. That's what Trackhouse and this new car has given me, particularly, I know best, the ability to learn and grow as a human, as a person, but also as a racer. And Justin and Pitbull give me that leash to go out and learn and fail, and I don't want to keep failing, so try to learn and be better. And I do think that I'm a better race car driver than I was earlier in the year, and the wins will come.
Sounds like the notebook is being filled, Dave, for this Alva, Florida native.
That sounds good for Ross, being in his home state. Back to the first topic of the day, and that was the Bubba Wallace penalty. Denny Hamlin's in a unique position. He owns the car that Bubba drives. You've also competed against him for years. So was advice on offer from you? Was it sought from Bubba this week on how to go from here?
Yeah, I mean, I think you know, his action was so reactionary in the moment. It was a split section you know, reaction. And you know, obviously not ideal, you know, from the team standpoint. I understand his frustration and his, you know, wanting to get the respect on the racetrack. And he was put in a tough spot, but certainly you just can't react that way. You know, we certainly don't condone it. But we also believe in Bubba and believe in, you know, the growth that he's had really over the last year on and off the racetrack. I think really since Nashville of this year, he's just really taken a huge turn for the better and been a great teammate and someone that we really relied on for our performance. So it's tough that's not the narrative that he's got right now, and it'll take a little time to build it back, but I think he'll be able to do it.
Your narrative is good track here today that you've won at before, round of eight, second race. First time for the next-gen car. What do we expect today?
Yeah, I mean, I think that this is such a great racetrack. I mean, this is a dinosaur of a racetrack. It's one that we used to have on our schedule all the time, which is a ton of tire fall off, lap time variation. It's going to see some good passing. Strategy is going to play a factor. But man, it's just the perfect mile and a half as far as the surface is concerned. So,
speaking of guys that race here a while.
Yeah, nice. But yeah, it's just a great track. And I think, you know, the next gen car really in general has performed really well on mile and a half. So I think that we should see no exception today.
We're looking forward to it. FUN, Marty.
Gonna be fun today, Dave. I'm just wondering if we're done with the flyovers, because we were ducking and covering here on the pit box. So, Steve, last week, Las Vegas, mile and a half track today. What did you learn last week that might give folks a preview of what might happen today?
I've learned that the vice of the playoffs is real. We started off the playoffs without a playoff driver winning in the first round for the first time ever. Then we set the field down to eight. And they led over 150 laps. And the moves these playoff drivers were making were aggressive. Joey Logano with a huge move to win the race. Yep. That's what I expect to see today. It doesn't matter the style of racetrack. It's the time of the year, Marty. Big moves and aggression.
Kyle, 7 weeks ago, you had Ross Chastain in your championship four. He's almost there. Number two right now. So what do his next 2 weeks need to look like if he wants to make it there?
Listen, everybody had Ross Chastain won't make the playoffs. Won't make it out of round one. Won't make it out of round two. Here he is looking at the final four. So when you look at it, for me, Ross statistically is the best restarter. Statistically has the best pit crew. Statistically has scored 10 more points than any other driver on mile and a half racetracks. this is that mile and a half he needs to make something happen today. But I see him statistically rolling into Phoenix, baby, rolling into Phoenix.
So, Steve, on the track, it has been an oddly quiet playoffs for Denny Hamlin. Is that a good thing?
Yeah, on the track for sure. Off the track, he's been talking safety, had a driver suspended. A lot's been going on. But when he gets behind the wheel, he's executing, something the 11 was not great at all year long. If you can believe it, he scored more points in the playoffs than anyone. And even in his long-standing career, the best average finish so far of any of his playoff runs, quietly Denny Hamlin,
wow,
getting it done when it matters.
When we come back, we'll talk about the art of racing at this Homestead Miami track. It's certainly risk versus reward. KP and Steve break down one of the best tracks on the NASCAR schedule next. Countdown to Green is brought to you by Sonic.
Sonic.
Change the past one leap at a time. Don't miss the new hit series Quantum Leap, Mondays at 10, 9 Central on NBC and streaming the next day on Peacock. You know, Steve, I love live TV. First it was a flyover. Now it's the first responders lap, which is literally coming right by the pit box right now. So, but pretty cool moment for everyone here at Homestead Miami Speedway. This track, no more high-risk reward maybe on the NASCAR calendar than this place. So, Kyle, when drivers say that, what do they mean?
Listen, they mean there's a lot of reward for running up there next to the wall, but there's an incredible amount of risk. All you have to do is just barely get into that thing, and we've talked about it. These composite bodies, they may take a little bump here and now and then, but the sidewalls of those tires, they don't like being against the wall. Look at this off Christopher Bale. This takes my breath away. This is a spoiler camera, and we see how close it is. Now, what's fascinating to me is he's probably 6 foot, 8 inches away from it. But the fascinating part is Christopher Bale knows exactly where that car is at. He knows exactly where to put it going in, exactly when to pick up the fuel and how, or pick up the gas, and how that car feels against that cushion of air. That's what I mean by risk, because you're right there at it, man. 6 inches of slip, you're in the wall, you're in the garage, you're out of points.
The reward is speed for Kyle. The risk falls in your lap, Steve. Sorry about that.
Well, yeah, let me give you another R. You know what this one is? This is the results of your risk. You're going to run right on that wall. It's fine. It has more banking. It has more speed. The sidewalls aren't the only real concern. Now, we have found the weak part of this next-gen car. We're going to take a look at our NBC virtual Toyota and talk about the tow link. It sounds fancy. It is a very simple part. We're going to take the right rear tire off. The link itself is in yellow. It's on all four corners. It holds the tire pointing straight. So if you bend it or you break it, we're going to pull this one out and show you what happens. Now the right rear tire points in. It points out. It doesn't stay straight. You want to steer the front tires. You don't want the rear tire steering on your own. This is a part that can be replaced on pit road, but it is required without a doubt. This is a great example. Joey Logano, this isn't the ride he's looking for. He can barely get back to pit road nice and slow. As mentioned, if you're fortunate enough to get back to pit road, these teams practice it. Chase Elliott's team did a nice job earlier this season changing that tow link. But we're talking 6 minutes, Marty. 6 minutes at 30-second laps, you're losing time.
All right, Steve, give me a few drivers who balance this maybe better than others.
So do you want the low-hanging fruit? Because they're
sure,
easy. Kyle Larson and Tyler Reddick, that's on everyone's list. But I got a name I think is being overlooked. Noah Gregson. He did it yesterday in the Xfinity Series car. He's now been in this 48, helping out Alex Bowman, who's out with concussion-like symptoms for multiple weeks. He's getting comfortable with this car. Noah Gregson might be a guy to watch today.
Yeah, and listen, I'm going to go with Chris Buescher.
Really?
I think, yeah, he's not been great at this racetrack, but I saw an interview yesterday with him when he was talking on TV, and he talked about how excited he was. He's qualified eighth. He's going to put it up there next to the wall and look for RFK to make something happen today with Chris Buescher.
When we come back, we'll hear from Ryan Blaney and also Christopher Bell, who for the second straight round finds himself in a must-win situation. Can he pull it off again? Find out what he thinks next. Elevate your taste buds with the new Sonic Chop House Cheeseburger. Layered with crispy onion strings and a creamy Chop House aioli over an all-beef patty with two slices of American cheese. Served on a toasted brioche bun for a limited time only at Sonic. Homestead Miami Speedway. For years, it was NASCAR's championship venue. Today, it plays host to one of the biggest races of the year. One of two final shots to earn a spot in the NASCAR Cup Series Championship 4. For eight drivers, the pressure is building and time is running out.
I'll be getting close here. Be ready.
Got it pretty good that time.
Turn number four, two cars get together. It's Eric Almirola and Ryan Blaney.
Oil everywhere, everywhere. M-spinning
got it pretty good that time.
Gosh, I'm so sorry.
Wreck on the backstretch.
Or how bad is it? Joke.
You see the flames go up there.
there, huh? Ridiculous. Keep it together.
Fair to say chaos lurks around every corner here at Homestead, Miami. After you watch that video, right? Here's what's on the menu presented by Sonic for today. While the playoffs will be the focus, the off-track headline this week was Bubba Wallace being suspended for this race after intentionally wrecking Kyle Larson last week at Las Vegas. Cup Series playoff races have been coming down to the wire with late race passes for the win. If a playoff driver wins today, that means an automatic berth into the championship four, just like Joey Logano did last week at Las Vegas. The Team Penske driver is locked in and racing for the title in Phoenix in 2 weeks. Steve, here's how the playoff standings look. Middle race in the round of eight.
Yeah, the races are coming down to the last few laps, and the rounds are coming down to the last few laps of the last race. You see how close the points are. I expect them to only get closer, if you can believe it, today. The only one feeling great, Joey Logano, with that win. He knows he is advanced.
See the bottom of those standings. Bell and Blaney both have their work cut out for them. Let's hear from both drivers, starting with Christopher Bell, who's with Dave Burns.
And Marty, last week when the race started, Christopher Bell was not in the red. Then you were caught up with Bubba Wallace's accident with Kyle Larson. Did you need to hear from him this weekend? Did you?
Are you talking about Bubba?
Yeah.
He apologized to me whenever I got on the plane straight away. So, you know, I obviously appreciated that. And then on Monday in our team debrief, he apologized to the entire 20 team. So that was really cool of him to do that. And yeah, just we got to go out there and focus on what we can control today. And you know, we did everything right last week in Las Vegas to earn points in the first stage, and it looked like we were on pace to have a really good day. So, you know, I've got faith in this number 20 group that we can go out there, compete for a win today, and see where the cards fall.
With two races remaining in the round of eight, it's not quite the edge that the Rova was, but having been there now this year, having to win your way in, is there some comfort there?
I mean, not really. You don't want to be in that position, but the good news is I was kind of keeping up with the point standings throughout the course of Las Vegas, and I think at one time I was definitely more than 30. I think I remember seeing 37 out. So the way that played out with the 22 winning was one of the better scenarios for me. You know, obviously we want to win, and we're going to try and win today, but we're going to control everything we can control. And if we get out of here with some good points, it's going to be a matter of what happens to all of our other competitors. So, you know, if we run top three in both stages, top three in the race, but our competitors are right there around us, it's not going to be enough. So we'll just have to go out there, run 400 miles, and see how it stacks up.
Great news is he starts in a good position on the front row to begin today's race. Kim?
Well, Dave, for Ryan Blaney, minus 11 to the elimination line. And Homestead hasn't been a great track for you. Only one top 10 finish and seven starts. Why should today be different for you and this 12 team at Homestead Miami?
You just hope you learn from previous races, right? What did we do good in those races? What did we do bad that we have to change? So, obviously, with this new car, you know, it's going to be a different race, I feel like, than what we've seen in the past. Some similarities. I think the wall is still going to play a lot, but it might move around a little bit more than what we've seen. So just a matter of kind of staying in it all day, you know, and trying to have a good day and make up for last week. That's all we can do, and hopefully we get this Menards Pennzoil Ford Mustang towards the front.
Outside of a win, what would make you and this team comfortable leaving here today headed into Martinsville?
Outside of a win, you took away.
Yeah, outside of a win.
I don't know. Obviously, you want to be in, you know, the round of four going to Martinsville, but at least anywhere within striking distance. You know, it's I feel good about today. I feel really good about next week too. So you just want to give yourself a shot, but I try to just focus on today and do the best you can and see where you're at afterwards.
Can you be the 20th different winner here today on the season?
Sure hope so. It'd be pretty cool, wouldn't it?
We'll have to see if we can break history here today, Marty, with a 20th different winner. Perhaps it's Ryan Blaney.
Yeah, that would be NASCAR history, Steve. And to Kim's point, the last 10 races, 10 different winners. This is not your grandfather's NASCAR where the same team wins every week.
Boy, what we're seeing right here is just a carryover of the start of the year. 19 different winners that continue to show up in victory lane, different names. And think about this. 19 winners without a Truex, without a Brad Keselowski. Wow. You know, without a Ryan Blaney. Mm. That's 73 career wins between those three names I gave you right there. And they haven't gone to victory lane yet, so it has just been a shocking year. The hardest year to handicap ever.
Kyle, I think I would learn my lesson after the last round to not count out Christopher Bell.
No.
But, you know, so they have Miami.
Yep.
They have Martinsville. But do you get the sense that if they're going to advance the championship four, it really needs to happen today here in Miami?
I have no sense of this team. And I say that. They had a great first round. They had a walk-off in the second round. They were running eighth right where they needed to be last week when they got in there. So as I look at it, he's having the best year of his career. But he can make something happen anywhere, anytime because of another reason.
Adam Stevens. That team has a winning crew chief on the box, a winning guy who knows how to make those decisions. So, no, I don't say that this is their best shot, but they've got to make something happen today. But they can make something happen here or Martinsville. They're that type of team.
Steve, let's jump back to Ryan Blaney real quick. Why can this team not finish race? I mean, they're terrific for 90% of a race, and the last 10%, it just falls apart. Why?
Well, it falls apart without a doubt. You know, these guys have won six stage twos. Six times they've been the best guy at the end of the second stage. They've never won this year yet, and I really think it comes down to, it starts with a few simple mistakes, and then you start asking what's going to go wrong this week, right? What is going to happen? You start to lose your own confidence about finishing out races. I'll say this, I don't think we know what's wrong with them in the final stage, because I'm not sure they're exactly sure. But if they do close one out, Barty, and that confidence instantly flips, it could be a streak.
Yeah.
That's a really good point. Didn't think about it from that point. Yeah, very good point, Steve. So what's up with Chase Elliott? A complete non-factor last week in Vegas. Can the 9 team turn it around today? We'll hear from NASCAR's most popular driver next. Countdown to Green is brought to you by Sonic.
Sonic.
When Corey LaJoy and AJ Styles enter each other's world.
Welcome to the garage.
Yeah, looking forward to seeing the world of NASCAR.
This is the only road course with banked turns.
This is what makes this track, right?
I'm actually kind of tired of talking about it. I want to see you in the real thing.
This speed, it's unbelievable. Welcome to Monday Night Raw.
I feel like I put on Superman's cape.
Don't miss AJ Styles on Monday Night Raw and Corey LaJoy on USA's Race for the Championship on USA.
This should be good. USA brought together AJ Styles and Corey LaJoy to experience each other's sport. Corey showed AJ around a few weeks ago at Charlotte. You guys may remember that. And AJ returned the favor at Monday Night Raw. You can catch it all on USA's Welcome to My World, NASCAR meets WWE.
The fans here are on their feet.
Coming to you, coming to you, coming to you, coming to you. Right front down, right front down, right front down.
Crashing off turn two.
Hello, yellow, yellow, yellow.
Oh, we're done. We're done.
Got a small fire up there.
Holy shit.
Up in flames.
Oh, we got a
Carl
fire
Edwards
out here.
Into the wall. He got tagged by the 22.
Back it out, back it out, back it out, back it out, back it out. Get low.
God.
Chase Elliott hoping to avoid all of that chaos today. You know, he's always been inspired by his family. And as he tells us in this edition of Show and Tell, even when his family can't be with him, that inspiration is never far away. In fact, it's usually in his pocket.
All right. Well, this is my Show and Tell item, 2022 NBC. So my grandmother gave me a cross necklace when I was, I don't know, it's probably been a long time ago now. Man, probably 15 years ago, I was 10 or 11 or somewhere in there. But I broke the necklace off of it a long time ago. But my grandmother has since passed away. She was someone that was very close to me. And yeah, just something I've held on to, a nice symbol of her and what she meant to me. She was someone I was very close to and you know, someone that meant a lot to my life. And just a nice way for me to always remember her.
Chase Elliott, Steve, might need a little divine intervention after a rough Las Vegas race. Certainly hoping they can recover here at Miami today. You know, two races left here in the round of eight. The winner at both of those tracks the last time, William Byron, is driver number 24, the man to beat in Miami again. He's with Dave.
Well, he's last in line in a pickup, which I guess is a good thing because that means you qualified on the pole today. But you start just below the cut line. So what are the vibes today?
You know, I think this is a racetrack we love coming to. It's one that we've had success, and it's one of Rudy's favorite racetracks. That always helps us have kind of that energy together. So, yeah, I look forward to it. These are the opportunities that you want to be in, and we're excited for that opportunity. We're not worried or anything. We want to get to these two racetracks and still be in contention, which we are.
Just to our left, William, there's a wall. It has some dents in it. It's painted seafoam green. Are you going to see a lot of that today?
Yeah, I like the seafoam green. It's a good color. So try to follow that rim all day and be able to you know, be on the ragged edge. So it'll be a great show for you guys and make for a lot of fun as a driver. I won the Xfinity Championship here and running the fence, and sometimes that's what it takes. Hopefully our car can do a lot of different things, but if that's what it takes, we'll go there.
Good memories of Seafoam Green, Marty.
Yeah, Seafoam Green means Miami, Dave, because we see that wall. We always remember this racetrack. So, Kyle, we're in Miami.
Yep.
William Byron won the last race. Going to Martinsville next week. William Byron won the last race. Is he maybe more of a threat for the championship four than people are giving him credit for?
I think so. He scored the second most amount of points in the playoffs, as you look at it, behind Denny Hamlin. But he said something there that was interesting. This is one of Rudy's best tracks. When you get to this stage in the playoffs, we're a team. We got to believe in each other. I got to believe that Steve's got my back, that Rudy has Williams' back. You got to believe that. And that makes this group stronger. That makes this group more dangerous. He went to Phoenix early in the year, won the second stage, fell off the map the second part, but I think they learned from that. So if we look at this race, look at Martinsville, and then they make it to Phoenix, they're definitely a threat to win the championship.
So, Steve, let's talk about his teammate, Chase Elliott. We heard from him a moment ago. He predicted coming into this round, he was a little bit worried about these racetracks. Was he right? Should Chase Elliott fans be worried? Only plus 17.
Well, they should be worried after the performance they put on last week in Las Vegas. It was non-championship-esque. It wasn't even playoff-esque. He ran outside the top 20, qualified outside the top 20. He was nowhere to be found. But what Chase Elliott is the perfect example is why the playoffs are a bracket system. Your regular season performance matters. He's leaning on that great regular season, all those race wins, all those playoff points. He only has two top tens in the playoffs, Marty, but those two were a win and a second.
Yeah.
So when they figured out,
wins,
they are on fire. He has won here before. They don't need a win here today. You know what they need to do? Just right the ship a little bit. Just a good solid day, and I think he can find his way through at Martinsville.
They certainly need some good momentum on the 19. Let's get a few more updates on other playoff drivers as we go through the field with our pit reporter, starting with Denny Hamlin and Dave Burns.
Marty, if anyone has worn the face of potential champion this year, it has been Denny Hamlin. The car has had speed. The pit crew is on page one of the stat sheet, and he's remained focused in the midst of juggling priorities. He'll be digging from 14th place starting today, but Denny Hamlin's 8 wins at the next 2 tracks are more than any of the other 7 drivers combined. Kim?
And Dave, for Ryan Blaney, despite Team Penske being fast at the Homestead test a few weeks ago, crew chief Miles Stanley told me they feel like they missed the balance yesterday in practice. It was just way too tight, and they did not have the pace they wanted. They made adjustments to free up the car, and they should know pretty quickly into the first run if they went in the right direction. They start 13th. And for Ross Chastain, he may be starting 20th today, but he has been stout on intermediate tracks this season. He has led 383 laps on mile-and-a-half tracks in 2020, and he told me earlier today he has every reason to believe they can lead laps here today, too. That poor qualifying effort was just a combination of Ross making mistakes and the car being just a tick too tight. So when the green flag flies, Dave, he should be able to pick his way through the field.
Christopher Bell won't have to do so much of that, Kim. He'll start second today. He did the hard work in the round of 12 by winning at the Roval. He was the oh, by the way, in the big incident last week. So close to a pole yesterday, he's in position to capitalize again today, even before his final chance to get to the final round next week. And finally, Chase Briscoe. He's in a tough spot. No stage points last week. He broke even, which I guess if you're leaving Vegas even, maybe that's a good thing. He starts midfield today. Tough again. Ripping the board so much has been a part of his sprint car route. We'll see if his 2 wins here at Miami and the Truck Series and the Xfinity Series can help things pay off for Chase Briscoe today. Marty?
Dave, even in Vegas is always a good thing. Steve will tell you about that. So
yes.
if folks are looking for a scrappy underdog team, Kyle, to root for, Chase Briscoe's your man. Should more people be paying attention to the career run he's on right now?
Yes, he's having the best year of his career, but there's 4 straight top 10 finishes. Okay, just under the radar. Nobody expect him to move out of the round of 16 to the round of 8. You just don't expect that, or to the round of 12. He's that guy. This is blue collar. He's that guy where you say, you're sitting in your house and you look out and you say, see that guy on that Mahindra tractor out there mowing my yard? That guy's going to win a cup championship this year. He's just
good.
That blue collar guy. You know what I mean? And you want to pull for him.
You want to pull for him, but I can make you a pro and a con list. Pro, 4 straight top 10s, best of his career, 1 here at Xfinity, 1 here in truck. Con, you're in the round of 8. You know what 4 straight top 10s get you?
I know. That's
eliminated.
Exactly. That's true.
Chase Briscoe can do it, but he has the moment. He's at the doorstep. It's time to kind of stand up and say, you belong
here. Great point.
Me something. I need to see some trophies.
That covers us on all the playoff drivers. So, Steve, give me a couple non-playoff drivers who might make a splash today.
Talk
the talk of the garage, Tyler Reddick, Kyle Larson. It was a 20-minute practice, and all you need was 20 minutes to understand there's two guys in here that understand the top lane, running the wall better than everyone else. It's Tyler Reddick. We watched him twice in his career come down here and obliterate the field, winning an Xfinity championship, and then switching organizations and doing it again. This is his backyard. This is his playground. Kyle Larson, the same way. Yeah. Every time you see him, he's unbelievable, but some mistakes this year. We got to have a clean race out of the five.
Yeah, you do have to have a clean race out of the five, and we've not seen a lot of those this year. I will say this. Since Kyle Larson came to Cup Racing, everybody said, just get him in the playoffs and let's get to Miami. Just get him in the playoffs and let's get to Miami. We're at Miami. This is not the race, and he's not in the playoffs. But I'm still, he's the guy on everybody's lips. He's the guy everyone's talking about.
And keep in mind, at a risk versus reward track, these guys have nothing to lose. They can hang it all out. If they hit the wall, who cares, Steve, right? You know, that's the thing for Kyle Larson and Tyler Reddick today. When we come back, time for our race-winning predictions from Miami. Will another playoff driver punch their ticket to Phoenix? Find out what the guys think next. Well, the atmosphere here at Homestead Miami Speedway, fantastic. Today's guys, and wait, we got a preview of the flyover, which will be coming up again.
That was a preview?
Yeah, just a minute.
I thought it was.
I can't wait for that. I think that was a practice flyover, Kyle. Here are the odds, Steve, for today's race in Miami.
Yeah, a little surprised by the favorite, to be quite honest. I expected Kyle Larson to be up there, and I expected Tyler Reddick, but not Chase Elliott.
Wow.
Not statistically one of his best tracks. Some great value at the bottom. You're telling me Martin Truex Jr. is going to go winless this year? I just can't believe it. 18-1? You'll get 18 times your money?
Ross Chastain down there as well. That's kind of a little bit surprising. So let's see who we think would win the race today. I have a feeling there's going to be a lot of Kyle Larson picks in this category. Yep, there we go.
50% so far.
Dale Jr. and Jeff with Kyle Larson. Look at that. Dave going with Christopher Bell. I like that. Man, could he pull off a must-win situation, back-to-back rounds. Kim going with Tyler Reddick, like that as well. Kyle, who'd you go with today?
I'm going with a Florida native and drives that number one car. His name is Ross Chastain. He drives a car for Mr. Rural Wide Pitbull.
Yes, indeed.
He lives up the road here, so going with Ross Chastain today.
Are you the driver of this bus for Ross Chastain?
I am.
You've been on
it
for 7 weeks.
I'm going to drive this baby all the way to Phoenix, baby.
Steve, who are you going with this afternoon?
I'm thinking chaos is going to provide, so it's not going to be about running the top. It's not going to be about being the fastest. It's about survival.
Yes. Mm.
And I think there's no driver who runs more using his mind instead of his feet. I think Denny Hamlin out-survives everyone, goes to victory lane.
It would be a timely win. Timely number four win here in Miami for Denny Hamlin. I'm going with Kyle Larson. I think, listen, what did you say, Steve, earlier? It's the low-hanging fruit. But they have nothing to lose. So to that point, Kyle, you know, they're a non-playoff driver.
Yes.
They're a non-playoff team. How will they approach the race differently than those playoff teams?
Well, I think we talked about it a little bit in the meeting this morning. Steve had a great point. There's two different races run out here. There's going to be so many different strategies, but there's two different races. These guys just go out and put it all on the line. They don't care. These other guys, they've got to temper everything they do. If you're in the playoffs, you've got to think about every move you make and make sure it's the right move at the right time.
Steve, two shots left to earn your way to Phoenix. Do the pit crews feel that pressure?
Oh, they know it. They know it because we're in the playoffs, and they know it because we're in a big event town. Miami makes everything huge. The place is electric. There's superstars and movie stars walking around. The drivers are used to it. These pit crew members, they are feeling the pressure.
No doubt about it. They have to deliver on pit road as well, and there will be a money stop. At some point today, the pit crews have to come through with that and put their driver out front. Time for pre-race ceremonies from Miami.
Ladies and gentlemen, at this time, we ask that you please rise as you are able and remove your hats as Olympic Heights High School Junior ROTC Color Guard presents our nation's colors. Here to offer today's invocation, please welcome Chairman of the Board of Directors from Jupiter Christian School, Mr. Donald Barnes.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we praise your holy name today for all that you are. Father God, we thank you for all that you've done for us. We thank you for this day. We thank you for this event. Lord God, we thank you for this great nation you've blessed us with and the men and women that fight to protect it every day. Father God, I just pray your healing upon us, that you would protect us from our enemies. Lord, we pray that you would just remain faithful to us, Lord, as we claim your promise that he who watches over us never slumbers. Father God, I pray your protection upon the men today, Lord, all that are involved in this great event. Father, that you be with the racers and the crew members, that you would keep them safe, Lord, that you'd help them to perform well. And we ask these things in the powerful name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
here to perform our national anthem. Please welcome Academy Award-winning actress and singer from Disney's Encanto, Adasa.
Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the
on the other side, Rick Allen, Jeff Burton, and Dale Earnhardt Jr. Another spot in the Championship Four is up for grabs. We'll go racing in Miami when we come back on NBC Sports.
Sleep until the work was done. That victory bell. One for the money, two another show. Three, start your engines now and rock and roll.
It's NASCAR Cup Series playoffs from Homestead Miami Speedway. Telecast presented by T-Mobile. Eight drivers still with a shot at a championship. One of those drivers, and Joey Logano, locked up a spot in the Championship Four a week ago in Vegas. Will one of the other seven drivers do the same and solidify their chance for a championship in Phoenix in 2 weeks? Hello, everybody. Alongside our drivers, Dale Earnhardt Jr. and Jeff Burton, Rick Allen with you. Okay, this racetrack is risk versus reward. The kids call it ripping the boards. Jeff, are they going to be able to do that today safely?
They're going to have to do it today, Rick. There's only two races left in the regular season. It's time to make something happen for some of these drivers. There's a tremendous reward for getting that car right up against the wall. You just said it, and rip the boards. That can get you a win, but it also can get you damaged and get you in the garage with your day done. who is willing to put it there and who is smart enough to put it there at the right time.
Yeah, some of the guys I think are really good at this racetrack. They're non-playoff drivers. We've seen a lot of non-playoff drivers win races in these playoffs this year. Tyler Reddick and Kyle Larson, they are the fastest. What will they do when presented with the opportunity to win this race? Racing around playoff drivers and their teammates. Chase Briscoe, another guy who thinks he's just as good as them too. He's in the playoffs. He could win today.
Chase Briscoe 9 points below the cut line. He's looking for that automatic bid to Phoenix with a win here today in South Florida. Let's get the engines fired up. We go trackside for the command.
And now, race fans, here to say the most famous words in motorsports, please welcome multi-platinum country music artist Kip Moore.
Drivers! Start your engines!
Fire up, Red. Fired up, everything's fired up.
The engines are fired up. The drivers ready to take on this Homestead Miami Speedway for 400 miles. NASCAR on NBC is brought to you by T-Mobile. More 5G bars in more places. Credit One Bank, a credit card company. And by Ford. Built Ford proud.
We really love the pressure, and I think that is what sets us apart. If we continue doing what we're doing, we'll get to the championship four.
Luck, or the lack thereof, is what Las Vegas was built on, and that's a big factor here today.
Absolutely.
Eight drivers know they've got a shot.
It's 306 miles from the Las Vegas finish line to the start line at Phoenix, and Joey Logano's going to punch his ticket.
And so let's go get a championship, baby!
You can feel the tension. This is not just another race.
For me, at the core reasoning of racing is the Cup Championship.
Winning a championship is a career-defining moment.
That's an extremely elite list.
I think it'll validate the work that's been put in.
Winning a race at the Cup Series level is hard enough, but winning a championship is even harder.
It's something that I've worked for my whole career. I've come very, very close to it.
And you have to just maximize those opportunities because you never know if you're going to get them again. You have to be willing to go to work and to go to fight and have that hunger to win. That's what is a difference maker, being able to call yourself a champion versus just a race winner.
Everyone wants to make a difference today. Want to take a look at today's starting grid, brought to you by T-Mobile. Up front for three spots, held by playoff drivers. William Byron up front with Christopher Bell. Byron keeping his streak alive of winning a pole every year he's raced in the Cup Series.
Back in row 7, Ryan Blaney, and three-time Homestead winner Denny Hamlin. Look at row 10, Chase Briscoe and Ross Chastain. Nobody has scored more points this year at the 1.5 than Ross.
A couple playoff drivers there in that 10th row. We look a little further back, youth and Cole Custer in the 41 and the 2 of Austin Cindric there in row 13.
Yeah, I like Ricky Stenhouse Jr. A lot of pace earlier in practice. He could surprise a lot of people today and drive through the field.
Biggest story of the week has been the suspension of Bubba Wallace for the on-track retaliation that he took on Kyle Larson. This was the event in Vegas a week ago, just at the start of the second stage. Bubba Wallace into the wall, then comes back down the racetrack, takes the 5 out, but also they clip the 20 of Christopher Bell. So those three cars involved, Bell a part of the playoffs. For more on these three cars, let's go to pit road, and we'll start with Dave.
And Rick, Christopher Bell told us in Countdown to Green that Bubba Wallace called Christopher, actually talked to him on the plane on the way home, apologized to Christopher for what happened to them, which was to essentially be almost last in that race, and then also to the 20 team, who he knows has been executing lately. If you talk to the guys down here, they know it too, but there's some things they just cannot control. What they have controlled this weekend is their speed. Christopher Bell, second quick in qualifying, and he hopes to give those views from the Toyota onboard clear sailing, the clear look all day long today in Miami, Kim.
Well, Dave, with Bubba Wallace's suspension from the on-track incident at Vegas, John Hunter Nemechek was tapped as the replacement driver in the number 45 Toyota this weekend. And when I talked to him earlier today, he said he came into Homestead Miami Speedway with no pressure and just to have fun. But after being at the top of the board yesterday in practice and qualifying fourth, things changed. He said now he has put a little pressure on himself, not only to complete all the laps, but to run top 15. Getting a great look with the Columbia PFG onboard camera of John Hunter. This team has been great on intermediate tracks this season, so we'll see what they can do here today, Marty, with John Hunter Nemechek in the seat.
Kim, talking to Kyle Larson about what happened last week, he said he has not heard from Bubba Wallace, has not gotten a text either from Bubba Wallace, but he said, you know what, I'm very much of a move forward guy. I don't need an apology from Bubba Wallace. For me, I'm moving on. I'm all good from my side. And boy, is he moving on with a quick race car today. Coming to one of his best racetracks, Larson, in the garage area, the prohibitive favorite among everyone that you talk to. They think they have the car to beat this afternoon. And an important point, Rick, they are a non-playoff team. They can take chances and risks that those playoff drivers simply can't take. Keep an eye on Kyle Larson all afternoon long.
Kyle Larson definitely wants to put a positive spin on the end of the season. Again, just three races remaining. All right, Steve, take us through the race breakdown.
Well, Homestead, Miami, a mile and a half racetrack with progressive banking. That's 267 laps for 400 miles. Stage one, 80 laps. Stage two, a touch longer at 85. And that final stage, 102 laps. You see the fuel window, 60 to 65. So a pit stop required in every stage for fuel alone. But these guys are going to want tires well before they're out of gas. This place eats the tires up. It's going to be fun to watch all day. Who can manage those old, slippery Goodyear Eagles?
For more stories on the playoff drivers and those right around that cut line, let's go back to pit road in morning.
Denny Hamlin was surprised, Rick, when he qualified 14th at the track where he has won three races. But when I talked to Chris Gabehart this morning, he said, you know, it's interesting. I think everybody thinks our shot to win and get into the championship four would be next week at Martinsville. He said, I disagree. I think it's here at Homestead, Miami. Our test was fantastic. I feel very good about our speed and how Denny will manage the race. I think that's going to be a big key here this afternoon. William Byron has the pole position for today's race. He has earned the second most points of any driver in the playoffs. Talked to Rudy Fugel about that this morning, and he said, you know, our bottom line is we've been executing. We've gotten a lot of stage points, but we don't have that great finish. That's what I want out of Miami today. Remember, Miami and Martinsville, the next two races. He's won the last races at both of those tracks, Dave.
And I talked to Chase Briscoe's crew chief, Johnny Klossmeyer, this morning about Chase running this track. He said it's kind of a lot like his dirt upbringing. He raced in a sprint car on dirt where the drivers are constantly looking for the moisture in the track. There is speed there. Well, at this track, you're looking for the places where the rubber isn't so that you can put your Goodyear Eagles there and make better time. He said Chase is very good at that. That may pay off this afternoon. Chase Briscoe starts 19th, Kim.
Well, Miami has not been a great track for playoff driver Ryan Blaney. He only has one top 10 and seven Miami starts. But as Ryan told us during Countdown to Green, this season is totally different with this car, and past performances at tracks aren't necessarily indicative of what they can do here today. But crew chief Miles Stanley told me they will not feel comfortable headed into Martinsville next weekend with anything but a win here today. Blaney trying to be the 20th different guy to victory lane this season.
Already the Cup Series has tied the record at most different drivers at 19, trying to break that record. And guys like Ryan Blaney or Martin Truex Jr., they have yet to get to victory lane. Well, Verizon Frontline is the advanced network for first responders. Today, Verizon is honoring members of the Florida Highway Patrol, Homestead Police Department, and several other frontline organizations who are a part of the ceremonial pace laps before the race. Please join us in honoring these first responders. Leading the field with some unique views is the Coca-Cola pace car cam. Looks back on that front row.
And I'll tell you, when we have overtime in NASCAR, I think this is the absolute best shot, right? As they come around for that last little sprint to the finish, you can kind of almost see the intensity in each windshield. It's a great look.
What can we expect on the restart, or actually the start of the race and all the restarts here today?
If it's paved, use it, right, drivers? I mean, from the white line to the wall, we're going to see them everywhere.
I was really surprised in the Xfinity race how they used the bottom of the racetrack longer into the run. There's a lot of grip on the bottom of the racetrack and in the middle, I think, with shifting as well. That brings the groove down the racetrack a little bit.
Early in a run with new tires, a lot of grip, the shortest way around the racetrack. Also, you want to be looking for clean air. You want to go where the guys in front of you are not. As this race goes on, you're going to see them migrate up toward the top.
So much talk has been going to the top. How many laps does it take before you get up there?
I would say in the old car, 5-10 laps, but this car here, you might be able to use a lot more of the racetrack here with the shifting, the grip, the bigger tire.
Another opportunity to punch the ticket to the championship four, and it starts right now. William Byron, Christopher Bell, see the green flag.
Already almost four wide off of turn two. Yeah, we are four wide. It's like Blaney way down there on the inside, making a lot of ground, trying to do what he can.
Blaney in the yellow, number 12. Out front, it's William Byron in that 24. Behind him, Christopher Bell in the 20. Byron's going to lead lap one.
You see how spread out they get on the restarts? Three wide, four wide. Which lane do you pick? First time these cars in this configuration have been on this track all at the same time. A lot of learning happening right now.
Still 2-3 wide back in the pack, sorting it out for different positions. And already William Byron up high on the racetrack. Right along with Joey Logano on the Ford Performance on board.
And you saw that 8 car going around the top of the racetrack around Denny Hamlin. Reddick on the fence up there.
See where Joey Logano is right now. See that black line on the right side of his car? There's less banking down there where he is. That's why there's less grip on the bottom of the racetrack.
Reddick might have got the fence there a little bit in the middle of the corner.
Yeah, I'll go with you. I'll go past the mic. I think it was a for sure contact with the wall and wanted to, but you see it doesn't slow him down. And you see why the top works. Back to the gas early. Momentum around the outside of that orange 19 of Truex is going to jump in line behind him.
Everybody else out front is on the bottom of the racetrack. We're watching some guys mid-pack here running the top, running the bottom, the middle. Reddick making a ton of time. Everybody's watching that. Spotters are watching that. They're going to give that information to the drivers, the ones that can't see it. The ones that are out front will get that information. Soon enough, everybody's going to start sliding up their racetrack trying to find the speed Reddick has up there. Reddick now to the middle of the track. You watch him right there in front of Denny Hamlin.
The other thing that's happening right now is if you're having to learn, how hard can I push this race car? Can I hurt these tires early in a run and it costs me later? Blaney clearly up to sixth place, started in 13th. So Ryan Blaney is not afraid at all to push this car early, trying to get to the front.
We're going to talk all day long, risk versus reward, running the top. Well, some wall contact acceptable, some not. This is acceptable contact right here, the 8, Tyler Reddick, one of the first guys up top, gets back in the gas. It just barely jumps the cushion. You can see a little bit of a tire mark on the wall. No harm, no foul. That type of contact all day with a smile. Unfortunately, though, the difference between that and too much contact could be just barely an inch. Ross and Denny have been duking it out for the last lap. Side by side down the back straightaway through 3 and 4. Now in 1 and 2, arguing over this position right here. We've seen these guys argue over a lot of positions this year.
Well, throughout the entire year, and Denny Hamlin's been making a list. He says Ross Chastain is on that list of guys that they have to look out for him because he is going to race them the same way they have raced him throughout the season. And he thinks Ross Chastain has not raced him fairly throughout the year.
Well, if Chastain has a list, everyone I think has been on it over the course of this year.
So this is them two going through 3 and 4. Pretty good distance between them right there. Really comfortable. No real aggression between any either driver right there. Just losing a little ground running side by side.
One thing, you know, the 11 car was way up the racetrack. I talked about it earlier, the banking. You know, it's the more you go closer to the wall, you see that black seam underneath heart of Hamlin's car. From that black seam to the wall has all the same amount of banking. So if you're going to try to pass a guy, you might want to get right next to him to have the same grip that guy's got, Marty.
Jeff, I think you've seen Denny Hamlin try about three different lengths to get around Ross Chastain. He finally was able to do that, picking up the 13th spot there. But talking to Denny this morning, Jeff, he told me, listen, I think at the end of these runs, everybody's going to be up by the walls. So to me, working the bottom, working the middle early in a run is a key factor. So is that a thing you think will be a big factor today as well, Jeff, working the bottom and the middle early in a run?
Well, listen, Marty, here's what I think. I think that everybody's going to be on the wall, but if everybody's on the wall, how are you going to pass? So you're going to have to try to find a way to use the middle of the racetrack if you're going to make passes. Like Ross Chastain, he's working right here, trying to understand. If he just drove up here behind Denny Hamlin, he's certainly not going to pass him. So Ross has got to try something else.
Ross has came from 20th place to be able to battle for that position in 14th. And look at that 16 car. A.J. Allmendinger. We haven't seen colleague really run exceptionally well often in the Cup Series. They've been fast all weekend. He drives that car around the 9 of Chase Elliott for 5th place, going after John Hunter Nemechek in the 45 for 4th right in front of him.
How about John Hunter Nemechek? Talked a lot about Bubba Wallace. Well, John Hunter got the nod to fill in for him in this 45 car. Speed right away in practice. Doing a really nice job. You talk about the deep end of the pool, top 5 in the starting last of a Cup race, Marty. That is as deep as the pool can get.
Also a little bit of pressure with that, right, Steve? And I talked to John Hunter about that earlier this week, and he said, listen, I know where this race team is. They've been on a fantastic run. All I want to do is just keep that going. A solid day. I don't want anything flashy. I would love to get a top 5, but a solid top 10. Keep the momentum going for the 45 team is his goal, Kim.
And we talked about the speed we've seen from Pauling on the club side recently. AJ told me this morning how happy he's been with the team and the gains they've been making. But here at Homestead Miami, it's all about running the wall, and that's still not something he's quite comfortable with. He got a little more comfortable in the Xfinity Series side, talked yesterday about watching Noah Gregson's line, but he said it's a totally different ball game with the next-gen car. He is very nervous to bend the toe link, getting too close to the wall, so that comfort level not there. And he said the biggest thing, trying to enter against the fence correctly and build that speed.
Saw that great battle with Ross Chastain and Denny Hamlin. Ross Chastain finally cleared him and moves up in front of Denny. Denny gives him a shot. That's something you're going to see all day long. If you're going to make the pass on the bottom, that outside may have momentum, and you have to make a determination. If you're going to pull up in front of that guy, Denny with a shot down the straightaway, no harm, no foul. But
Denny Hamlin,
buddy, don't do it again.
Yeah, chasing after the 4 of Harvick right now. William Byron out front. You're watching NASCAR Cup Series playoffs on NBC is telecast presented by T-Mobile. For the first time, NASCAR fans can view every lap of NASCAR Cup Series races from inside the cockpit of any car they choose. Visit NASCAR.com/drive, or you can download the NASCAR mobile app. Looking down on this mile and a half here in South Florida, aerial coverage brought to you by Geico. And Byron and Larson still holding the top 2 spots, but Larson running up against the wall, Byron a little lower than that. Drivers, break down the 2 lines here for us.
Yeah, it's interesting to see these guys as they try to work around this racetrack. The 5 a little faster than the 24. This is really the first time we'll be able to analyze how this car races on this racetrack that the drivers love so much. Now in this turn, both drivers running the same line. Jeff, how is that affecting the 5 car? Look, he doesn't like it. He has to get out from behind that 24, get some clean air underneath that car for some downforce.
It takes the air away from him, but watch William Byron. He is not going to enter on the wall the way Larson does. See, William moves well. Now this time, Larson looking for that clean air, thinking Williams was going to run all the way against the wall. If he would have known William was going to run a car width off of it, he would have gone to the fence, because he would have been where he wanted to be and have clean air. So they're guessing what each other are going to do.
Yeah, we haven't seen Larson run really the same line twice in turns 1 and 2. Both these guys right against the wall again in turns 3 and 4. Larson's going to stay against the wall this time. Remember last time he turned down trying to try that out, see if that would be a little bit better, but he decides to stick to the fence there. He's not going to be able to drive up and pass the 24 car, though, if he is running the same exact line. Now back to the wall in 1 and 2. You see the 24 a little bit off the fence. This will give that 20 or the 5 car a little bit of speed off of turn 2 and down this back straightaway to close the gap.
And, Junior, that's the perfect example of a playoff team and a non-playoff team. William Byron in the playoffs, his teammate Kyle Larson right there in the five, not in the playoffs right now. So, Steve, this is what Rudy Fugel told me this morning, the crew chief for William Byron. We just can't afford to run the wall early on. There's 248 laps to go. Larson has nothing to lose today, so he can run that wall, be aggressive all day long as much as he wants.
Yeah, but it takes a lot of patience to do what William Byron is doing. Even if he was asked to do it, you know a little higher on the racetrack has more speed. So doing a nice job kind of operating the plan behind the wheel of the 24.
Let's listen in to the radio of Ryan Blaney.
Step no grip. No rear drive off the on the exit. Let's turn in the middle. Lift off the wall, but once again, it's 3 and 4 on the tight.
It's frustrating for a driver to have a tight race car at this racetrack. You need it to be free and turning all the time. If this slides the nose in the middle of the corner, you can't go anywhere. You don't want to be too loose on entry, but you definitely hate the tight issue in the middle of the corner probably the most.
The 12 is a fascinating group. 8 stage wins this year. 6 times they've won the second stage, yet cannot find a way to victory lane. Now they're almost, I think, mentally fighting this battle, right? When it doesn't go right a couple times, you're like a golfer. If you look at the water, guess where you're hitting your golf ball? Right into the water. And I think this 12 team kind of does that at the end of these races, right? They start thinking what could go wrong, and they almost force themselves into a mistake. It'll be interesting to see if the 12 can clean out the second half of the races, Kim.
Well, for crew chief Miles Stanley, I asked him specifically about when Ryan gets upset about the car on the radio or anything in general, and he noted that Ryan's rate of recovery when he's gotten upset on the radio has improved drastically over the years. Sometimes he just needs to vent. Right now, talking about that car being loose, Miles talking to spotter Josh Williams, saying if we can just give him more long run grip, he will be fine. Just let him air out his grievances.
Watching these leaders run the lap times that they're running, 34.70s. Look at the rest of the field, except for Reddick. Everyone in the 35s. 3/10 of a second or more. I think once Reddick gets up here, brings the fight to the 5 and the 24, we're going to be in business. But look at the 5 and the 24 are on the wall tighter than anyone else. It's like a half a foot, maybe a foot more than the rest of the field. That's the difference. 6 inches or 12 inches closer to the wall, 2/10, 3/10, 4/10 in speed.
Also two Hendrick cars. So, you know, obviously Hendrick came here knowing what they needed. Both of those cars making great grip. Drivers can drive them hard. They have confidence to put them right on the boards. Dave.
So I wanted to know about Tyler Reddick, since so many folks went toward him to find out, would they be good here? Would they run like Tyler? What does Tyler do? And even though he's currently 5 seconds off the pace, Randall Burnett, his crew chief, told me that this car drives pretty much for Tyler the same way the old car did. There was no big difference. He said it's more about a sense. Tyler just had a special sense for running close to the wall, and for him it was just as easy in this car as it was in the old car. So no difference, even though the way they do it and sometimes the way it looks from behind the wheel, like here with John Hunter Nemechek, is a little different.
Riding along with the Columbia PFG onboard camera of John Hunter Nemechek, and we're actually on the helmet with John Hunter Nemechek here.
Look how close he's going to get to that wall, man. Love watching this view. Listen to the throttle. In and out of the gas through the middle of the corner. Being patient, not trying to rush the throttle when you run the wall. When you run the top, really, what you're trying to do is make the straightaway faster. How you do that is by getting in the gas earlier than what you might do on the bottom of the racetrack. But you have to be patient with the throttle.
A driver being patient with the throttle. It's hammered down here at Miami. Out front, Byron has led all 26 laps up to this point. Caution is out. John Hunter Nemechek spins off of turn number 2.
John Hunter Nemechek running fourth. See him right against the wall. Just like we see in other guys trying to make grip. Just comes around on him.
Yeah.
Tires up. That's John Hunter Nemechek. This is his first race in this car. This car is difficult to drive, and you have to dance on the edge. And right here, around it goes. And that's what all the drivers that race this car on a weekly basis talk about, is that car makes a lot of grip right up until the top moment it doesn't. And then around you go. John Hunter just learned it the hard way. I don't think, Steve, it's too much damage right there.
No, from the outside, everything looks like it's pretty well up. And as you mentioned, the tire They pop as he slides around, but I don't think he drug anything too bad off the bottom. At the same time, Dale, we had a little lead change between the 5 and the 24.
Yeah, the 5 running the top of 1 and 2 gets a great run down the back straightaway. I think this was more of William Byron saying, hey, man, I see you're quicker. I'm going to let you have it down here in the bottom of 3 and 4. The 5 has not ran the bottom of 3 and 4. Maybe he found something down here. Maybe he liked what he had to do there to be able to make that pass and tries that later. Maybe he learned a little bit. It might pay off.
Well, we saw the 45 come around, and all the radios were kind of monitoring. We're here free, free, free. It seems like everybody's lacking rear grip. So the driver's going to love to come to pit road now after only 30 green flag laps. Get a fresh set of tires on the car. You see that one car back there, what is it, 3 or 4 up, riding right against the wall? We saw that yesterday. And we're talking about how the marbles were kind of, the rubber that comes off the tires was blowing up. So Noah Gregson kind of did the same thing yesterday in the 9 Xfinity car. He rides around slow and actually tries to pick up that loose debris so it's nice and clean when he's ready to go race there again. A little dirt racing-esque. You know, if you're going to run the top, you kind of roll it in under yellow. We'll see. Saw a couple cars join him, so he's not alone up there now.
You talk about that one car, Ross Chastain. He's picked up 8 spots since they dropped the green flag. So had a good car in practice. Did not qualify as well as we thought he would have, but making a nice recovery right now in 8th place.
Guys on the move. Austin Dillon's grabbed 19 spots. LaJoy has made up 11. Logano 10. Almirola 8. As you mentioned, Chastain, double digits there. 12 spots since the start of the race. Kim?
And no surprise, he said he made a mistake in qualifying, had a much better car than 20th. We've seen that pits from the 8th position. He said it fired off tight. Overall built neutral, though, so it's going to be 4 fresh Goodyear tires. Sunoco fuel for the 1 car, Dave.
Christopher Bell gives up 5th position in the 20 car. He said, I needed just a hair more front turn, and it was tail wagging pretty good off turn 4 at the end. Adjustment for that, Marty.
Bottom left of your screen, Kyle Larson, you see the chassis adjustment. Said he was too free behind his teammate William Byron, and he had to be really patient. But he said in 1 and 2, really feel like we can move around. Byron, though, said he was free as well. Drag race off pit road between the two Hendrick cars. William Byron picks up a spot, taking advantage of that pit stall number 1, Rick.
Yeah, number 1 stall, very advantageous, especially for William Byron here as he wins the race off pit road over his teammate in the Dixie Vodka 400 from Homestead Miami Speedway. NASCAR on NBC is brought to you by Liberty Mutual Insurance. Only pay for what you need. Toyota, let's go places. And by Northern Tool and Equipment. Start solving your projects today at northerntool.com. We're made for this.
If there's anything left for Carl Edwards, he's going to have to show it now.
Tony Stewart comes across the line, and he's won the NASCAR Sprint Cup Series Championship.
Carl Edwards into the wall. He got tagged by the 22. Make room, Richard Petty and Dale Earnhardt. There's another 7-time champ. For over a decade, this has been the place where champions were crowned. The last race of the year, and so many great moments. So many drivers will say that this is their favorite track. Why?
I think they love it because you can run anywhere on it. We love a racetrack where we can move around. Running up against the wall is fun for a lot of drivers. I loved it because I could get in my car and drive to Captain Tony's in Key West. That was my favorite part about it.
Proximity.
Yeah.
Uh-oh.
Oh, boy.
Uh-oh. Is one going to pull the other one out?
The one in the yellow is losing his deposit.
Yeah, I think he's in trouble.
And this is what Junior looked like after Captain Tony's.
Well, thankfully these two aren't on the track as we're getting ready for the restart. Field approaching the Geico restart zone. William Byron, Kyle Larson making up the front row again.
It's a good launch by William, and he's going to go down into turn 1 to the bottom of the racetrack. 3 wide for 3rd place. Reddick around the high side here. Can he draw alongside of Larson for 2nd?
What we saw was that Kyle Larson on a long run certainly had the best car. But many times in this race, we see a late race caution. I know it's early, but you got to be thinking right now, how can my car take off early? What do we got to do to make it go fast and have long run speed?
We knew it would only be a matter of time before Kyle Larson and Tyler Reddick were running right up against the fence and up front. Right now, they're running 2nd and 3rd.
How about Brad Keselowski battling Chastain for 5th place in this number 6 BKR? They're bringing it today. AJ's bringing it now into turn one, turn three there, side by side with six. Brad backs out. Chastain and AJ. AJ's going to clear two cars in one corner.
Kyle Larson's underneath William Byron. Got a great run off turn four. Kyle's going to drive it deep in the corner.
I'm surprised to see this early in the run. This 24 took off and left them at the start of this race, but now the 5 in a short run speed trumps the 24 car. How can Reddick get up there and bring the fight? While these two guys are battling, can Reddick get into the middle of this?
Larson used the same move both times to get past William Byron down to the bottom of the racetrack to make the pass. Reddick's fallen back. He's now 5 car lengths behind the 24 of William Byron.
I wonder what happened to William that made him have to give up that spot, or what he thinks about his race car that he doesn't like. Certainly now he has some sort of complaint, I'm sure, giving up the lead.
Still not right up against the wall for Larson as the fresher tires still working well. A couple lines off of the fence. Chase Elliott all the way up to 4th. Allmendinger is 5th. Brad Keselowski, as you mentioned, with RFK Racing back there in the 6th spot. Blaney, Chastain, Bell, and Martin Truex Jr. all in the top 10.
AJ trying to get around this 9. He's been hounding the back bumper of Chase Elliott for a couple corners here. Dave, what you got?
Talking with crew chief Alan Gustafson this morning about that 9 car. We know that they were not great last week. Alan said it was definitely not one of their better performances. They worked very hard on this car at home. I asked him, is it a new direction? He said, I wouldn't go that far, but what we used at Vegas did not work. So we had to do something very different, and they definitely did it here. Chase has been happy with the car. Just a small adjustment on that run, Marty.
William Byron, no word from him, Junior, to answer your question, but he has been complaining about the car being free, especially when he's behind his teammate Kyle Larson. So keep that in mind. William Byron a little bit too free, gave up that lead. He lost all that advantage with clean air.
Let's take a look at the Xfinity fastest lap, and it's Kyle Larson. No surprise there, 32.88 on lap 37. So just a couple laps ago, he's posted the fastest lap of this race. And now things are heating up for that second spot as Tyler Reddick has closed the gap. He's right on the back bumper of William Byron.
So Tyler Reddick, we know he loves to run the wall, but right now making really good time on the bottom of the racetrack. What's William Byron going to do? Reddick did not clear him. Now Reddick's just going to go wherever William is not, right to the white line. This will be a very difficult pass running that very bottom.
It wasn't difficult back there for AJ, taking away 4th place. Here comes Chase, though, back on the outside. I'm surprised as you, trying to be able to make that pass on the bottom, that Reddick is trying that with the option of going higher. The 24 runs the middle of the racetrack, so if Reddick, I think, goes where the 5 car is leading the race, I think Reddick makes this pass quickly.
Talking to AJ Allmendinger, that 16 car, how well he was working on the bottom. That's what he did in practice. Like, he never really got to the boards. He just worked on that car on the bottom to get it set up because he felt like you're going to have to run in different places.
Big run coming from Reddick now in the 8. He'll close the gap once again. We'll see what he does with the momentum here in 1. He stays up high.
And he goes to the top, Rick. I think he wished he would have did this a lap ago, because watch what happens here. He's going to go the outside of this 24 off of turn 2. The 24 is going to block him. He's going to go the inside with the momentum he created.
Crossover move. Will it work for Reddick? Can he clear the 24 in 3 and 4? He's going to stay on the bottom of the racetrack. As the 24 gets the momentum built up, Reddick, he'll slide right in front of William Byron.
Byron's actually going to try to pass him back. He had a choice there to stay in line or take the bottom of the racetrack down here in 1 and 2.
But look what Reddick did. He went to the middle of the racetrack. He didn't go all the way to the wall. You'd have thought Reddick, as much as he loves the outside, loves the wall, he would have just gone to the wall. But instead, he said, no, I'm going to run down here on the bottom. Now he's going all the way up to the wall.
Yeah, and he gets to choose his line now as he chases down Kyle Larson up in front of him. Larson gained about a second over these two as they were fighting for that second spot. We'll see how long it takes for Reddick to reel him in, Marty.
Rick, so what's up with playoff driver Denny Hamlin all the way back in 18th? When they came down pit road, they lost seven spots because on the right front, they couldn't get the gun to switch over from reverse to taking the lug nut off to putting the wheel nut back on, Steve. So we talked in the pre-race about the pressure on these pit crews, Steve. No doubt, this has been one of the best teams on pit road all year long. Used to be Kyle Busch's team. Now in the playoffs, it's Denny Hamlin's team. They made a mistake on the first stop.
Now, the problem for, you know, the pit crews is they're like kickers. Nobody talks about the nine you make in a row. They talk about the 10th, the one you miss. That's what everybody remembers. Pit stops are the same way. You can have great pit stops all day. One mistake is what everybody's going to remember. If you're going to have a hiccup, while you would prefer not to, early is better than later. The 11 has enough laps to recover.
11 running up against the wall, as Marty mentioned, running now in that 19th spot. Briscoe behind him. They're the two furthest back playoff drivers. Larson, though, leading here at Miami. Race fans, Credit One Bank and American Express are giving you the opportunity of a lifetime. You can enter for your chance to win tickets to the Daytona 500 for 25 years. And potentially, you would see Denny Hamlin win maybe his fourth Daytona 500. Already a three-time Daytona 500 winner. And Denny Hamlin, after falling to the back, has been very aggressive, has made his way all the way up to 15th now. And we just heard him on the radio moments ago. He's talking about being aggressive.
Good, bye, Evan.
Went up clear, so clear.
Copy that.
We got to take every...
Copy that. I'll call it tight.
Still 30 to go. Rip it. Let's go.
What he's trying to tell him is, like, as soon as I am clear, I mean the very moment that I've cleared the car I'm passing, tell me, because I need to take every inch I can and get back up the racetrack in the fast lane. Don't wait till I'm, you know, a half a car length. Don't call it conservatively. Be very aggressive as a spotter to clear me around these cars.
And Junior, they restarted 23rd for Denny Hamlin all the way up to the 15th spot. And yes, we talked about sort of the bridle, Jeff, that's been put on these playoff drivers. Don't go too close to the wall. Don't damage the car. That was Denny Hamlin saying, hey, I want permission. I want to run the wall. I'm tired of running back here and the throttle being put on me, or the governor, if you will, being put on me to not go as quick as I want to go.
Yeah, it's time to go, Marty. Everybody knows it. Everybody knows how important this race is. Now's the time. And Byron's talking about it. Crew chief's talking about it.
Remember, playoff drivers, they're looking for every point they could possibly get, because there is a guarantee that at least one driver will get into the championship four based on points. And at the end of stage one and the end of stage two, points will be awarded to the top 10. So these playoff drivers trying to get into the top 10, Dave.
Rick, before this race began, Christopher Bell was 23 points below the cut line. When the race started, he was on the outside of the front row in position to receive 9 stage points if he could hold that spot. At the last restart, he was 4th. That's still stage points. He's been going backwards ever since. He's now 11th. He is out of position to receive any points at the end of stage 1. No report yet from the driver as to why he's going the wrong way.
It's a great shot. Christopher Bell doing some work with his right hand as well. Watch him. He's going to come off the corner here, reach down and shift from 4th to 5th gear, right? So we knew shifting was going to be a thing. There it is. Pulls back on the lever, goes back to high gear, turns down to turn 3. Even running high up on the banking shifting. I thought for sure they would do it on the bottom. We talk about how difficult it is to run the top. Junior, now I want you to take your hand off the wheel and give me a shift in the middle of each corner. Rick, that's making each task even a little tougher.
Well, I want to take a look at the telemetry brought to you by Progressive. Look at him feather the throttle.
So much work. That's one of the reasons the race car drivers love this track so much, is you have to dance on the edge of grip. Driving into the corner just a little bit too fast absolutely kills your corner. If you don't drive in hard enough, it kills the corner. So you're always dancing. And what that means is, if you drive at 170 miles an hour, watch him at the end of turn 1. Watch how fast he gets going. He's got pressure coming from behind, so he's 180 miles an hour. If he drives in one car length too deep, he can no longer put the car where it needs to be. If he goes to the gas one car length too soon, the car won't stay in the lane he needs it to. That's how precise you have to be driving these race cars.
Watching these guys run up front, the 8 car almost spun out off turn 2. Watch this car get loose. Reddick sideways right here. Look at that dirt track move right there. We saw just a moment ago John Hunter Nemechek wreck his car off of turn two. Very similar situation, pushing the car up against the wall, up against the limit of grip. Now he's moved away. He's like, oh, I got to step it back a little bit. Let's be more conservative. It's early in the race, stage one. But right there, almost sent that car around.
Steve. The question is why, right? If you're driving this race car, the only way to make lap time is to be pushing. And they've lost 2 seconds from the time they dropped the green flag until what they're running now. It's 2 seconds of pace off. The tires are just completely wearing out. But Tyler Reddick can't quit. He can't quit trying hard. He's got to keep pushing. And when you're pushing, you're going to cross over the edge every now and then.
Well, the challenge for Tyler Reddick is he's slip sliding around, doing everything he can. That five car of Kyle Larson is almost disappearing. Look at the lap times on the left. I mean, look at this right here. We say hundredths matter, tenths matter. Well, how about half a seconds? Half a seconds really matter. Kyle Larson was the talk from the test, the talk from practice, and since he has taken control of this race, we are seeing excellence on display. Kyle Larson running the top is as good as anyone that perhaps has ever done it. He has made more mistakes this year than ever, self-admittedly, after being knocked out at the Roval. If he can make, you know, put a mistake-free race together, good luck. Another half a second faster than the second place car.
They can hook up the back of that eight car. Reddick's, I think he'll meet him somewhere up front. Marty, what you got on the five?
Wow, Kyle Larson is just so quick. Cliff Daniels knows it and knows this is a long run as well and reminded his driver of that on the radio just seconds ago. Listen.
Almost 5 seconds now. Smooth, just smooth.
That simple communication, Steve, telling his driver, listen, you have a huge lead. This is a long run on tires. Save me a little bit at the end. That's a key communication from Cliff Daniels to Kyle Larson.
And knowing how fast this five was, we would have had a discussion before the race, maybe a code word or some information that lets Kyle Larson know to move a foot down. Just give me a little, just a little bit. Let's not make an unforced error 62 laps into this race. And now maybe Kyle Larson feels like that's a conservative line. There's a solid 4 inches outside that five car. Impressive so far early.
As good as Kyle Larson is, he's never won at Miami. Maybe that changes today. After 45 years, Halloween, the most acclaimed and revered horror franchise in film history, reaches its epic, terrifying conclusion. Laurie Strode faces off for the last time against the embodiment of evil, Michael Myers, in a final confrontation unlike any captured on screen before. In theaters and streaming only on Peacock now. It's NASCAR Cup Series playoffs on NBC. This telecast presented by T-Mobile. Out front, Kyle Larson now has an 8-second lead over second place Tyler Reddick. William Byron's running in that third spot. Allmendinger and Truex making up the top five. Elliott, Austin Dillon with a good run up in seventh. Brad Keselowski is eighth. Blaney is ninth. And Joey Logano rounding out the top 10 as we have just under 13 laps to go in stage one.
We're watching Chastain right here, but this 20 car, Christopher Bell dropping back to 14th place. Dave, what you got on this 20?
So he finally radioed his crew. You just saw Ross Chastain pass him on the bottom, but that's not his only problem.
I have no idea, Adam. I go to the top, I get passed on the bottom. Go to the bottom, I get passed on the top.
Top, I get passed on the bottom. Bottom, I get passed on the top. There he is on the top, getting passed on the bottom by teammate Denny Hamlin. Right now, they need a solution. The driver doesn't have a lot of answers to give back to the crew chief.
So, Steve, what I need to tell you is why, right? Yes, I can see that they're passing you on the bottom. I can see they're passing you on the top. But what is my car doing that's allowing them to bring the attack to me? I have no defense. Why? What will my car not do? If I don't tell you that, there's no way you can fix it.
Well, but the new world of NASCAR, though, as a crew chief, I can go into that SMT, which is basically the driver controls, and I can see what you're doing with the steering, what you're doing with the pedals, what the speed of the car looks like, and where Denny Hamlin is faster than you, right? Jeff, if you can't tell me what you don't like about your car, I can at least tell you where you're losing the most time. Maybe then you can adjust, push, be more aggressive, and see whether it's the front of the car, the back of the car, something is not giving you confidence to hustle this car.
And Junior, to be fair to Christopher Bell, he can't afford a mistake. And where he is in points, listen, this stage is coming to an end. Most likely he's not going to get stage points, but you can't take a bad situation and make it worse. Christopher Bell pushes too hard right now, gets himself into the wall, gets spun out, damages his car, then he's in a must-win next week. So there are times you just have to manage a bad part of the race.
Right now, Chase Briscoe running back in the 18th spot, Dave.
And Rick, that's only one better than where he started the race today, so they need an answer as well. Not sure if the latest version of Behinda Tractors comes with an onboard camera, but Chase has one today, and right now they'd like that view to be further going forward. He can't get into the corner, can't charge the entry. They've already made one adjustment for that on the first pit stop. Johnny Klausmeyer's crew chief radioed back. We're going to give you another adjustment for that same thing next time you come down pit road. Marty?
Dave, I think you can describe it as high-quality problems when Cliff Daniels is begging Kyle Larson to back it down a little bit now with a 9-second lead. Listen to the radio.
Be very smooth right here. You're taking, you've got an 8.1-second lead. Make sure the tires stay on it to the end. Be nice and smooth right here. That's all we need. Still so much racing left. 199 left in the whole race.
So, Steve, to Cliff's point, I mean, this is a 40-plus lap run on these Goodyear tires. Would you be a little concerned? I think a little bit further than they thought they might run in stage one.
Well, I think you're a little concerned. You have to go run a little bit further, but I've yet to see anything out of any of the cars all weekend long that tire wear is an issue. The five car, could you slow down? I mean, he has 9 seconds on the field. He has so much raw speed, he doesn't have to push it. But the five's in the rhythm. He's now lapping the 77, who's running in the 32nd position with 7 laps to go. I will tell you, though, Rick, what's got my attention is what's about a quarter of a lap in front of the five car, and it's a mess. It is a whole group of cars right here. Look at them. 6 or 7 cars going into turn three. You can just see and hear. Leaders coming. Leaders are straight away back. The give and take is going to get shut off here with 7 to go in this group.
The thing I heard in Cliff Daniels' voice was almost, you don't need to go this fast. You have an 8-second lead. There's 199 laps still to go in this race. It was almost like, I'm not going to say it to slow down, but in my voice, I'm going to tell you, let's save our equipment a little bit.
Well, not saving the equipment, the 7 of Corey LaJoie. We talked about the pressure of the leader coming. Last corner, we saw him. He got into the wall on corner exit. Now he has to continue the push for 6 more laps to try to stay on the lead lap. Let's take a look at it. Just a little high there, guys. Little
free. Loose.
Yeah.
Got a little loose there. All those guys have been flirting with disaster there for the last several laps, trying to pass each other, trying to create more distance between them and the lead car coming to put them a lap down.
That incident, though, kind of separated that pack. Now they just need to make lap time. They need to quit worrying about racing each other and make lap time to try to stay on the lead lap. Good battle right here.
Yeah, Byron has fought back now. He wants that second spot back because that's 9 points at the end of the stage if he can grab them. He needs those points as he's one of the playoff drivers fighting to get into the championship four.
He drives into turn one really deep, slides up the racetrack. Not technically a slide job. A little bit of crossover here coming from the 8 car. Down the back straightaway. I think he's going to lift. Yeah. Lets him back in.
Tyler Reddick, knowing that his car isn't what it needed to be right now. 5 laps at the end of the stage. Don't put myself in a bad situation. See right here, Truex on the outside of him.
Yeah, something issue with the 8 right now. Tyler Reddick, he slowed way down there. Looked like he was checking to see if he had a flat tire.
He has no more right rear tire, no more side bite. Going to try to nurse this thing home. Hopefully without any issues in the tire, no cording.
And remember, he was the one who was sideways, so he had to wear a little bit of those rear tires out going sideways down the backstretch.
Yeah, he's tiptoeing this thing home here, guys. We watch the battle for second. Look at this 19 car of Truex to the inside of the 24, not the preferred line. Byron fighting back on the top. Going to be a drag race down the front straightaway.
And although Truex is not in the playoffs, he's taking points away from William Byron if Truex can get by him.
Truex going to dive into one. Slide up the racetrack. Lap car in the way. That's going to be a pick for the 24.
William Byron's going to take advantage of it. He's got to hold on for 3 more laps here in Miami.
Must feel great for Martin Truex Jr. right now. They've had just one of those years. Nothing could go right. Good speed, but nothing. No way to finish a race up front early at a racetrack where I feel like he's one of the best. Really good at this discipline. Very good at saving tires. And here he is late in a run, taking the fight to William Byron.
And this information from this 19th team as far as air pressures, all the things they've done to put speed in the long run for this car is going to his teammates, all the other Toyotas, trying to figure out what they might be able to do to their cars to improve.
Martin Truex Jr., another one of those drivers who has not found victory lane in 2022, could set the record if he gets up front wins here in Miami. Already 19 different winners, he could be 20.
He has a faster car, but you can see how difficult this pass is to make.
Well, and he wants to make it, but he has to decide
how much risk he really wants to take at the end of stage one. I love to see Truex up here, right? A veteran. We weren't sure he was coming back. Announced midseason he will return for another season. I'm thankful for that. And it's great to see a veteran like Truex not just kind of throwing it in on the year, right? Only a couple races left, but he's out here still looking for that win.
The five of Kyle Larson coming through 3 and 4 for the final time here in stage one, and he will do it. The fifth stage win of the year. Kyle Larson gets stage one.
You have to wait a while to see second, Rick.
Pretty amazing as there's a good battle for fifth.
Oh!
Right up against the wall. Chase Elliott sneaking by.
You don't think 1 point matters? There it is right there. Chase Elliott for eighth.
Took eighth away from Ryan Blaney. Right out of turn four. Larson, the big winner. He gets stage one. William Byron, the highest finishing playoff driver. He is in second. Elevate your taste buds with the new Sonic Chop House Cheeseburger, decadently layered with crispy onion strings, a creamy Chop House aioli over an all-beef patty with two slices of American cheese and served on a toasted brioche bun for a limited time at Sonic. Well, this week on Wednesday, make sure to join Jeff Burton on NBC Sports on Sirius XM. That's NASCAR Radio Channel 90. That'll be Wednesday at 9 a.m. Eastern. Join the morning drive, and Pete Pistone and the Bagman, always entertaining. Jeff, what do you think? You got a few things to talk about this week?
Oh, I have a feeling after this race, we're going to have a lot to talk about. And then Martinsville coming up next week. That's always exciting. So, yeah, it's always fun to join that show. Fans calling in. Good time.
Stage one gets done, and only four playoff drivers in. Of the four, Logano a part of that, but only four playoff drivers gaining points in stage one with Byron, Elliott, Blaney, and Logano. And of course, Logano locked into the championship four already with his win last week. Kim.
And Ryan Blaney, top left of your screen, going to make a stop here, looking for an air pressure adjustment to free him up running the wall. He said, I'm just too tight up there. I can't do anything. But then battling rear grip on drive off. So just free moving down again. Air pressure, four tires and Sunoco fuel, Dave.
Chase Elliott was not happy with himself, giving up a couple of stage points there at the end. Needs just a little bit of an adjustment for no tighter landing. And the fire off was better that time, Marty.
Four fresh Goodyear tires for Kyle Larson, who said, keep it as it is. I would say so. The car very impressive into the run. Very good for him. Nine critical stage points for his teammate, William Byron. A lot tighter that run. And had an interesting comment, Rick. He said he had steering shake during much of that run as well.
Rick, I get nervous pulling into a parking spot or driving down the interstate a few inches from the Jersey barrier. Look what these drivers do it here at Miami. Inches off the wall, north of 150 miles an hour with the precision of a surgeon.
It's NASCAR Cup Series playoffs on NBC. This telecast presented by T-Mobile. The all-new 2024 Ford Mustang was just unveiled last month. The new Mustang is the seventh generation and will have options for everyone. Whether you want convertible or coupe, a Coyote V8 or a 2.3-liter EcoBoost four-cylinder, manual or automatic, Mustang will have your option. An exhilarating fighter jet-inspired digital cockpit is gaming coming to real life. Ford fans cannot wait for the seventh-gen Mustang to come to NASCAR in Daytona of 2024. Want to check in on the Peacock Pit Box with Kyle Petty. Kyle, you talked earlier today about risk versus reward. Are we seeing any of that in the first stage?
You know, for me, watching the playoff contenders, it's been kind of calm. I've not really seen a lot from them. I've seen Denny Hamlin and Ross Chastain and Christopher Bell. They're on the struggle bus right now, and there's no risk, there's no reward when you're on the struggle bus. The only risk for a reward that I saw was Chase Elliott, that last lap, squeezing out 1 point.
Yeah, went right by Ryan Blaney within inches of the wall and within inches of Blaney. For a few updates before we start stage two, let's go to Kim.
Well, Rick, Martin Truex Jr. is still looking for his first win on the 2022 season, and he has a great record here at Homestead Miami Speedway. He's finished top three in four of the last five races here, but this season only one top five at intermediate track. So I asked crew chief James Small what's been the problem. He said mistakes and bad luck have kept them from victory lane at miles and a half. He feels like they could have won the last four, Dave. 100% they feel like they can win this race here today.
Kyle Petty just referenced the lack of reward for the risk that Chase Elliott took. Was he mad about it?
Me, man. Run around there and give up two spots like that. So stupid. Do we even get any points? Probably not.
Yeah, we got some points.
That's right, he got some points. And Marty, no one puts more pressure on Chase Elliott than Chase Elliott.
No doubt about that, Dave. I want to call it the finish in stage one for Brad Keselowski. Finished seventh in that stage. And then the pit crew did their job. They gained him three spots here on pit road. He'll start inside row number two. I just talked to Matt McCullough's crew chief just a moment ago. He said, man, we have been so good at the mile and a half lately. It is nice to finally show it. Rick, Brad Keselowski trying to keep a streak of winning a race in the Cup Series for 11 straight years alive. He only has three races left to do it.
Brad Keselowski, what a run and what a turnaround they have made at RFK Racing now, joining Roush Fenway Racing as an owner driver now. Field coming out of turn four and approaching the Geico restart zone to get stage two underway. Martin Truex Jr., a good shove on the five of Kyle Larson.
Playing it to the inside of Dylan. Dylan backs out of the gas. Now he's fighting back to the middle. Up front, Larson on the high side. Truex in tow.
Truex will get Larson a little bit of a push right here down the end of the back straightaway.
Bottom's been pretty good down here in three and four. Really on all the starts and the restarts, this bottom's worked really well for a lot of guys.
Truex struggled big time through three and four right there.
You look at the top of the screen, three wide, just barely out of it as the battle for the lead continues. The eight of Tyler Reddick, slow pit stop. Issue with the jack, restarted outside the top 10.
A little bit of momentum working for the five of Kyle Larson.
He's going to clear.
And he clears that 24.
Yeah, this 24 a little tight on the last little run. You have to imagine they worked on that car. We'll see if it helps this 24. Truex to the bottom of the racetrack. We watch back here in the field, though, the 1 and the 16 real tight around the top of the racetrack. 3 wide, Denny Hamlin and the 1 together again.
This is Bell. Big move by Christopher Bell in the 20 all the way to the bottom of the racetrack. He tries to take the spot away from the 11 of Denny Hamlin.
These restarts are so aggressive.
And now cars all over the track. A big wobble there for Austin Dillon in the 3.
Yeah, the 22, I think Logano either helping him or giving him a little shove there. Got him out of shape. Austin's done a great job thus far in this race moving forward. He continues to try to do that.
Ross Chastain with a little bit of a run now, looking to the inside of Allmendinger. Can he make this pass?
These two guys, they race so similar, throwing blocks on each other. AJ trying not to give up that spot, but he does.
I think we're starting to see the Ross Chastain of the early season when he was aggressive, making moves that a lot of people question, but that's just the way he raced, and that's the way he won two races.
Yeah, but I think AJ will bring that fight to him. They, like I say, they're too similar. Definitely going to butt heads on the racetrack next year when they compete against each other. AJ trying to fight back, take that spot back. AJ, you pass him, he's not like, okay, you know, maybe you're faster. Next corner, man, he goes right back to you. Kim, what you got on that one car?
We talked to Ross Chastain during Countdown to Green and asked specifically this, the aggression level. We saw it the first half of the season. We haven't exactly seen it this half. And he said it's just him evolving as a driver, and he's become way more smart about when to make aggressive moves. He acknowledged the fact that maybe he was being too aggressive too frequently for inconspicuous points and spots, whereas now he knows when to make the right moves and the aggressive moves at the right time when it matters. And right now, points matter as he hopes to make the championship four.
See on the bottom, the battle between the 1 and the 16 on the top, Blaney and the 9. Blaney's had great speed. We're looking for a finish out of the 12, looking for that first win. And the 9 car was shockingly non-existent last week at Las Vegas. Qualified outside the top 20, ran outside the top 20. He really improved. Showed up here, had a great qualifying effort, and doing okay, running in the fifth position, which is kind of what the 9 needs to do. No more, no less. He had such a great regular season. So it's kind of status quo for the 9, but it seems like every time I look out the window, guys, he's got a little bit on defense, not offense in these runs.
The Penske cars seem to fire off really, really well. Joey Logano right there on the screen, 228 points earned in the playoffs. But this 12 car's moved forward on restarts. And we see that out of Penske all the time. Short run speed, short run speed. How long can that car hang on, Dave? What you got on the nine?
Well, in talking to Chase's crew chief this morning, Alan Gustafson told me that they're still looking for a feel that this driver wants. It's a feel with this tire in this race car. I said, have you ever had this happen before? He goes, oh, yeah. He said an example would be Jeff Gordon in 2014 was incredible with a high downforce car. In 2015, the rules changed and all the downforce was taken away. It took a long time for even someone as good as Jeff Gordon to get used to that. He said, we're still working through that with Chase Elliott. This week is an improvement over last week. Marty?
Boy, Dave, Denny Hamlin cannot go on restarts, and he's frustrated about it. Listen on the radio.
Damn it, I can't go. Too tight.
So, Jeff, this is a back-to-back restart. We've seen this from Hamlin. The restart before this one restarted 19th, fell back to 24th. This one for Denny Hamlin, he restarted 9th. Now he's fallen back to 15th. So how do you manage that behind the wheel if you're Denny Hamlin?
Well, you can hear his frustration in Denny Hamlin's voice because he knows that it's so difficult to pass. And he said he's tight, right? The car will not turn early in the run. Maybe that's okay late in the run. Maybe that extra rear grip helps him later. But you give up so much at the front end.
What I find fascinating is he's right here with two other teammates, the 18 of Kyle Busch, the 20 of Christopher Bell. Their other teammate, he's up in third place. What's different about this 19 car that allows him to have the pace and the speed that the other teammates don't have? They're obviously all three struggling on restarts with tight race cars. They can't fire off. It cost them a lot of time early in the run. They survive on the back end of the run, but they've already lost too much pace.
The other surprising thing about the 11 and not having the pace that the 19 has is when they were here for the test, the 11 was hands down the best car here at the test. And all of the drivers noticed it. They thought it was incredible that he could be so much faster than everyone else. As a matter of fact, Chase Briscoe said, we thought we were the best car. But then Denny Hamlin was out there 0.2 seconds faster per lap than
here,
we were.
And the 19 here taking a second position or trying to take it from the 20. But we heard the same thing about Penske. Penske really fast in the test. All weekend long, they've been good. Hey, they're running well. They got both two cars in the top 10, but not the speed that we expected those guys to have, certainly in qualifying. They may find it throughout this race, though.
Martin Truex Jr. trying to take that second spot away from William Byron.
I think we're going to have to attend some of these tests because everybody said they were the fastest. I'm going to have to see some data. I'm going to have to see some lap times here.
Well, hey, Steve, how many times have you left the test with the chest all poked out, excited? You come back and you can't do anything right.
Every time we tested here, we left feeling great because we had so much more speed running the fence. Everybody else worked the bottom in the middle of the racetrack in the test. We never did, so we were always faster. So this place can give you false readings and false expectations.
Well, you also stayed in Key West, too. So
that's right.
That was something.
We certainly did.
One guy that's happy right now is Kyle Larson, already 67 laps led today. NASCAR fans, don't let anything pass you by. The official app of NASCAR Tracks lets you stay up to date on the latest race and event information from all of your favorite tracks. All you have to do is search NASCAR Tracks in the App Store, and you can download for free. Right up against the wall here at Homestead Miami Speedway. It is, once again, Kyle Larson out front by a second and a half. Pretty wild ride for John Hunter Nemechek early in this race as we ride along on the Columbia PFG onboard the helmet cam. And great sounds and sights from the shot.
Thought he was going to try to drive into the corner to pass his teammate Ty Gibbs right there in that 23, the black car, the Monster Energy Toyota at the top of the racetrack.
Remember, John Hunter Nemechek was running fourth.
Yep.
Spun this car, made contact, got back here in traffic, and he has never experienced this before. And we hear drivers talk about this car behind other cars is a very challenging car to drive, and this is the first time. And John Hunter Nemechek, he is mired back in 28th, can't go anywhere. Ty Gibbs in front of him. Ty struggled in this car as well.
Love listening to the car shift. Downshifting in each corner. Oh, he's having to get out of gas right there. Big, big wiggle. Kim, what you got?
Well, Rodney Penske has one driver in the championship four already with Joey Logano's win last week. He's trying to get a second. driver in with Ryan Blaney jumped on the airwaves to offer his driver a little encouragement.
Ryan, you're doing a great job out there. Just hang in.
Four. Thank you, boss. Keep getting a little better here, dude.
You're hitting a lot of those guys that are getting points, so feel good about that run. Just keep working on it.
And you heard the emphasis on points. I talked with the team this morning, and they said last week was such a great reminder of how important stage points and stage wins can be. Despite a late race mistake last weekend and finishing 28th, they still salvaged a day with a good points day. So Ryan Blaney currently running in the fourth position, Marty.
Kim, what a solid day it's been for Daniel Suarez, fighting right now with A.J. Allmendinger. That puts him back in the top 10. He's been in the top 10 pretty much all day long, along with his teammate Ross Chastain as well for Trackhouse Racing. I asked Daniel, how would you assess the year so far? And he said, for us, it's been a huge jump from a contending team to a winning team. And I know there's way more potential at Trackhouse. That's what we have. It has to be excited for next year, Dave.
When teams tested here, the 14 team came with Chase Briscoe, came with this exact car and ran all 2 days. Unfortunately, in qualifying, he got to the 19th position only. Crew chief told me that has been an issue with us all season long, and since the start of the race hasn't been able to charge the corner. Well, when they adjusted for that, the fire off, the beginning laps in this car was just way too tight, and it wasn't until the 16th lap when the driver radioed in and said it's finally starting to turn. Rick?
Well, let's keep it here as we head into the Toyota Fast Lane, where our own Rutledge Wood joined some Team Toyota drivers for a fun day of drifting.
We're here at Eagles Canyon Raceway in Texas with some Toyota Racing Pro Drifters, Ryan Turk and Jonathan Castro. We're going to try to get our bearings in and then see which one of us is best in the GR86 street car. Let's go. Enough to rent a car on his own, but you're gonna go drifting today. So exciting!
Good job, buddy. Good job.
P1 tie with a 7.5 total score. Christopher, a close second, and then the rest of us also enjoyed the day. Time of our lives. Thank you, fellas, for making it happen. Woo.
We saw a little drifting earlier out of John Hunter Nemechek coming off of turn two. Problem was he didn't score very well. Got that one sideways, brought out a caution. But right now, it has been just that caution and one for the end of stage one, the only two times that the yellow has come out.
Rick, we mentioned it coming to the restart, how the 8 of Tyler Reddick came in inside the top 5, a slow pit stop, loss of track position for the 8. He restarted outside the top 10. I don't think it was that big a deal because I thought he'd just drive right back to the front. It's been anything but smooth sailing, though. Now he's in the 13th position, Dave, and trying to fend off the 11 of Denny Hamlin.
Yeah, he's not going to be able to do it. He just radioed his crew about 2 laps ago, tight center and off. Steve, you've dealt with that here with drivers at this racetrack before. What's the answer?
You know, Dave, I'll be honest, tight center and off, if I could have fixed it, I'd still be on the pit box because this place could be so, so difficult. But to your point, the struggle with tight center and off is as you free it up, you lose that entry comfort. And to run the top, you have to be able to drive in there with some comfort. If you're loose at all, chasing the back of the car. So that tight center and off, very hard to fix, even harder to fix in traffic. And this is what got the 8 in trouble. The right side looks okay. Pretty normal. I mean, pit stops are so fast anymore with these single lugs. But watch it, Jack, man. He goes to the left. He struggles to get the jack set, struggles with the handle. I mean, it looks like a simple mistake, but that mistake right there was 6 or 7 spots on the restart. And once you get back there, to Dave's point, how do you fix, you know, tight center and off? Clean air is one of the biggest fixes, and you see the difference right there. Basically a 10-second pit stop for Kyle Larson, 13 for Tyler Reddick. So 3 seconds on pit road, 6 or 7 spots, and now dirty air is making that tight condition even worse.
Reddick running back in the 15th spot right now.
Just burned it up. I really don't know. It was so tight taking off. Now it's just got no rear grip and plowing.
Oh, see, now you have the tight with no rear grip. That's like the dynamic duo of setup issues.
He's dropping like a rock. Last several laps have been pretty bad for this 18 car. Kyle Busch closing in on him.
Well, yeah, because you got to remember, they made adjustments thinking they were going to restart in the front 2 rows, right, Dale? And now he's back here.
fighting traffic. Back there is Tyler Reddick. And it is a little loose. Larson, though, out front with a three-second lead over Truex. Six laps to go in stage two, and welcome back. NASCAR Cup Series playoff telecast presented by T-Mobile.
Kyle Larson's looking good, Rick. 4 second lead. 39 laps complete in an 85 lap stage. I believe we're within a handful of laps from green flag pit stops, probably 5 or 6 laps kind of at the most. They might even come a little earlier. And guys, we talk a lot about tire wear and tire grip on the racetrack. I think that makes green flag pit stops difficult. Pretty easy to overrun those worn out tires. Marty.
How about this run for Brad Keselowski? Gave up a few spots on the restart, but clawing his way back, trying to get Chase Elliott for fifth here. Best run for RFK that I can remember for the 6 team, at least, in a long while. Meanwhile, the 11 car for Denny Hamlin still trying to claw his way back. The window, though, is open for pit stops. Coming down pit road right now, Joey Logano, Kim.
And Joey Logano can do a little bit different than what the field does. He already has a win last weekend, locking himself into the championship four. He said he just needs the back end to hang on a little bit more. Four tire Sunoco fuel for Joey Logano.
There's the 14 car of Chase Briscoe. He comes to pit road now. The car is better as soon as he got halfway through the run. It really wasn't turning at all. Finally, 16 laps in, it started turning. You see the wrench going in the window there. They made a couple of chassis adjustments today to try to help Chase Briscoe.
Pit road entry looks like a caution. There's so many cars coming in at the same time. Look how busy pit road is. They're up and down pit road. Marty.
Look at that busy pit road. Denny Hamlin coming down pit road, as we mentioned, trying to claw back after that rough restart earlier. He told Chris Gabehart on the radio, we have to fix that. I cannot give up spots like that on a restart. Four fresh Goodyear tires for Hamlin and a decent chassis adjustment trying to free it up earlier in the run. Kyle Larson babying his race car and just so quick. Set a little bit tighter. Oh, and a problem there on pit road. Oh, the 11 and the 5 almost make contact as well on a very tight pit road here at home. Said Miami. He said 1 and 2 feels much better, but the car a little bit too tight early in the run. And William Byron said the car was way too free the longer they ran, so they are also going to make an adjustment here, trying to tighten it up at the end of the run. It's funny, it's like the opposite way it used to be, Dave, when the cars would start loose and go tight. Today they start tight and go free as they run.
Chase Elliott's car, same as it was last time. That's the report from the driver of the 9. He needs the back to lie down a little bit more. Air pressure adjustment for that and a chassis adjustment. Wrench going in the window of the 9.
Green flag stops. This is where mistakes can be made. And the 9 of Chase Elliott taking the access road and getting back out onto the track.
That's a good point, Rick. You know, you enter pit road from the track like everywhere we normally run, but you exit on the access road. And that access road, there's no speed limit. Once you leave pit road, as you see right here, Bell running right up on the back of his teammate, the 18 of Kyle Busch. No pit road speed limit on that access road. As hard as you can try to leave, you just can't get out into the grass.
And that access road is slick. It does not have much grip on it. It's really easy to get yourself in trouble. Let's go back and look at Denny Hamlin on pit road. Drops to Jack, leaves, comes to 77 of Landon Castle. And then almost in the back of 5.
And those instances right there is why drivers sometimes drive through too many pits. Cars coming in and out of boxes around them, sometimes trying to avoid. You can make the mistake of driving in through too many stalls, entering. Almost saw Chase Elliott do that during his pit stall as well. That's how some of those issues happen. You wonder, like, how does the driver make that mistake? Well, that's right there is how it happens. Trying to avoid things on pit road during green flag stops.
See the bottom left penalty, 48, Noah Gregson too fast on pit road. The 8 overshot his pit box, so not a penalty, but cost him time. He had to back his car up. Christopher Bell currently leads the race, waiting to come to pit road. This car right here is trying to run a little bit long for two reasons, Rick. He's definitely losing time to new tires, but if he gets a yellow, that's a huge advantage for the 20. The way he's going to try to figure this out is come down pit road. You could either only take 2 tires and shorten the stop. That would be aggressive at a high wear racetrack. Or you're going to put new tires on and have a ton of speed versus the field later in this run. There you go. This time, let's ride on board with Christopher Bell and see what pit road entry looks like. We talk about how it's very, very slick. This is exiting turn 2 drivers. I expect to see maybe a hand out the window. And just watch how busy a driver is coming to pit road.
He's got a car to his inside. He's going to let go. A couple cars here. Look at him getting loose, almost spinning out as he tries to slow the car down.
Now he's looking at his dash, trying to get the RPMs right. That's how you have pit road speed. It's all RPMs. Now it's about maintaining that. You want to be right against the limit. Don't drive through too many boxes. Put it in neutral, foot on the brakes. Steer wheel straight.
Christopher Bell was asked to give them a few more laps. He did so on track, but they were about 2 seconds slower than the drivers with the fresh tires. The report from the driver, tight in, snappy loose off. That's what they went to work on. That's what Ed Stevens had the crew try to repair for Christopher.
All right, so what is that 2 second slower going to cost Christopher Bell? We mentioned the access road. Here's a great look at it. As fast as you can go. This is a great view right here off the right rear spoiler. He was running 17th before the pit stop. And now he's going to come off from turn two. You see on the upper right, the graphic, the five of Kyle Larson is going to be almost right on his right rear bumper. Now, luckily for the 20, a couple lap fresher tires, he should be able to scoot away from Kyle Larson, but he almost goes a lap down running long on those tires. There's the five right there coming into view.
Yeah, race leader now, Kyle Larson, is 4.4 seconds in front of Martin Truex Jr.
I would feel confident in what you're telling me, Steve, but this Larson, he's been half a second faster in the field, so
that's maybe, why I said should, because I wasn't real sure.
Maybe Larson actually runs him down even with those new tires. I'd be a little concerned. I'm watching if I'm the crew chief, like the lap times, and I'm telling him, man, you got to go. No time to waste.
That is, yeah. He should drive away.
Bell came out and his coming off of pit road lap. Has him running about 33.6 seconds. And so a good lap there. He was the fastest car on the racetrack. But as you guys mentioned, Kyle Larson, he was the fourth fastest car on the track at a 33.9. So Larson flying around Miami. Today's aerial coverage brought to you by Geico. Down on the five, Kyle Larson. He's out front by almost 6 seconds now over Martin Truex Jr. You're watching the Dixie Vodka 400 from Homestead Miami Speedway.
31 on pit road. It looked like he had a flat right front when he came to pit road. Now it looks like they have some sort of issue, which tells me maybe it was a loose wheel. Something has gone on with this tire wheel combination. There's a great picture of the lug nut. I mean, the right front, it's definitely flat, so I'm not sure if there was extra damage from wall contact or what exactly caused this issue, but what a great year for Justin Haley. You hate to see this, and a great day for this 31. Qualified near the front, showing a lot of speed on the 31. You hate to have it end up losing laps with a mechanical issue. Currently two down, it'll probably be three down when he comes to pit road, but it was anything smooth for green flag pit stops for a bunch of cars. We see this battle between the 9 to Chase Elliott and the 1 to Ross Chastain. The 8 of Reddick, we mentioned they had to back up into his pit stall. He actually lost a lap. So Tyler Reddick, one of the favorites heading into the race, a lap down. And an issue also for the 3. So RCR in general, look at this right here. I'm going to circle it. A good pit stop is 10 seconds. You know, maybe 11, 12, 13, a little problem. When you give up 13 seconds on your pit stop, that will ruin a good day. It has killed the 8's day. And the 3 is barely hanging on to the lead lap in the 21st position.
Yeah, we talk about speed on the racetrack, drivers being able to get up against the wall, but everything has to work right.
Green flag pit stops have already taken place. 28 laps still to go in stage two. Make sure to check your fantasy lineup.
What should I get, Rick?
You got to make those changes before the end of stage two. Want to get a few updates. The guys that are below the cut line, and we'll start with Kim.
And Ryan Blaney making the most of this day despite the team not having the car that they really wanted. I talked to crew chief Kyle Stanley this morning and he said they did not feel like they were great in practice and they did not have the pace they wanted. He also noted it was going to be hard to pass. So there were two things that they were focusing on coming into this race. Very clean, quick pit stops and really good restarts. We've seen both of those things from the team today. Great stops on the team's part and great restarts on Ryan's part, gaining positions. He currently is posted in the fourth position, hoping to hold on, Marty, to get some of those valuable stage points.
Tim, what a surprise. Denny Hamlin minus 21 below the cut line right now. We've talked about the restart issues. Here's what Hamlin said to Chris Gabehart a little while ago about that.
Back is playing a lot better on exit now. Just plow on restart so I can go. Got to be able to hold my position.
Denny Hamlin knows those restarts have to get a lot better in stage three, Rick. They're not out of it yet, but they certainly have a long way to go.
Marty, you see Chase Briscoe is in the red as well. Started the day in 19th position. Currently runs in 19th position. They've been able to go nowhere so far, undoing adjustments that they've made previously to try to help Chase to the end. Meanwhile, the 20 of Christopher Bell, we saw him run long on that green flag sequence. Great Toyota onboard right here from the right rear of the race car. He has gotten back all of the positions that he, in theory, gave up, back to 17th position now, but no further. They still have to find a little bit more for Christopher Bell to ultimately go forward.
What a shot.
And Christopher Bell again coming into this race with a deficit after he was taken out in the incident between Bubba Wallace and Kyle Larson last week in Vegas.
Watch this battle right here. This one car, Chastain, a little bit quicker than Chase Elliott. Chase been able to fend it off, make it really, really difficult for Chastain to be able to get around him. Me and Steve were talking about it during the break. Chase needs to be careful not to lose too much track position here. I don't think he has the pace in his car, at least he hasn't shown it yet, to be able to recover from any lost track position.
And Chase, you can see he's running down a lane because the car in front of him, he's trying to get clean air, right? And that gives Chastain an advantage by being able to run the top. Chastain, a big run right here.
Behind them, the teammate of this one car, Suarez, you see him on the leaderboard there in eighth place, doing a great job working through this field. Harvick in ninth. Couple cars we haven't talked about yet. There's the 99 right there on the right side of the screen, trying to close in on this battle. Chastain again to the bottom of the racetrack, can't make the pass. Chase just sitting there like, hey man, I'm going to run in a defensive position. You do what you want to do. I'll give you plenty of room to try to get around me, but I'm going to run where I think I need to run to maintain this spot. Good little race. That's why drivers like this track. A lot of options for Chastain here to try to make this pass happen.
But I'm sure it's also frustrating because he's trying the low line, he's trying the high line, he cannot get by that nine.
It is frustrating, but it's also exactly what you love about being a race car driver. The challenge of trying to get around this NASCAR or this nine car is exactly what you want to get behind the wheel for. This type of battle is what these drivers love.
Up against the wall again for Ross Chastain.
Look how much distance he lost to the nine, just trying to kind of reset here. It's interesting how that happens with this car. We didn't really see that with the old car. Looks like when they kind of follow each other around the track, they lose a ton of grip. Sometimes really have to get out of the throttle when they lose all the air underneath the car with the transducer in the back. So that's kind of something we see. He'll be fighting the back of that nine car, almost making the pass. Then a minute later, he's this far behind. We'll look 2 laps later. He'll be right back on his bumper again. Kim, what you got on Truex?
Yeah, let's get a Toyota driver update on Truex. Currently running in the second position. And while some drivers have been complaining about balance and chasing grip, Truex has loved what he's got in the car. He said it's gotten better as they've run. He thinks it's because the track is building rubber. It's very good on the long run. And he feels like he's had enough rear grip to run the wall. And that's something I talked about with crew chief James Small. How comfortable is Martin running up on that high line? And James said he's way more comfortable running the wall in this car than previous generation car. Truex told James he feels like he's back in 2006. And it's way easier because you have more front drive off. Currently in the second position, looking for his first win on the season. Perhaps Martin Truex Jr. will be a 20th different driver in victory lane.
It's hard to believe. I know we've had 19 different winners, but Truex, you would imagine, should have been on that list. Brad Keselowski as well. I mean, these guys right here, no wins this year, and they have a winning streak they're trying to keep alive. Yeah. Blaney, Truex, and Keselowski. I'll give you one more. Those three drivers right there have 73 combined career wins. That's like two straight seasons worth of winning, plus a little. So, I mean, their numbers are impressive. It's quite shocking. It's quite shocking we have 19 winners. Double down the fact that those three aren't one of the 19.
Yeah, two of those being former champions of the sport and still have not found victory lane.
See right here, Chase Briscoe trying to make something happen, running back in 20th place. right against the wall. Got loose, saw him wiggle a little bit, chasing up the racetrack. Eric Jones underneath him, just right along. No big damage.
That happens all the time around this racetrack. The five car, right around the bottom of the racetrack. Looked like he might be coming to pit road there for a minute, but really making some good time down there when he needs to use the bottom.
And Briscoe's running 20th with decent lap time for with most drivers. The problem is Larson, Truex, Byron, they're so fast, but the guys behind them are all running very similar pace. Nate, what do you have on Briscoe?
Well, Jeff, right after that green flag pit sequence, where Chase was running was a danger zone for getting laps, so he was told you're going to have to push it to stay on the lead lap, and that is what he's been doing. Right before that little wall contact, he said going looser. You nailed it, Burton. Loose race car.
So Larson trying to put Briscoe a lap down here at Miami.
Go, 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 go.
Here's the thing about wrong turns.
What the heck was that?
They invite serendipity.
Whoa!
The unimaginable. The unexpected. The unforgettable.
Hang on.
So embrace wrong turns. Because you never know.
Hey.
Where your next wrong turn will take you.
Look at this.
Wow.
Toyota, let's go places.
We get out, fired up, hook big ones. We get out and rip it, and we track them down. So crack a Mountain Dew, get out and do.
Verizon Frontline is built for those we all rely on, built to prioritize first responders. Built for extreme conditions. Built for America's most reliable 5G network. Because when seconds count and lives are on the line, the people we rely on need technology they can rely on. Verizon is the number one network choice in public safety. Verizon Frontline, the advanced network and technology for first responders.
Get crafts, sporting goods, restaurants, and the future of NASCAR all from your neighborhood. DoorDash.
The NASCAR season will come to an end in Phoenix, but the championship weekend will last forever.
The greatest are the ones that seize the moment.
Four championship races in 3 days, all set against the stunning backdrop of the desert mountains.
Hard, you got it, you got it.
Night racing, a doubleheader, and a Cup Series champion crowned on Sunday. It's a weekend you'll wish would never end. Get your tickets now at phoenixraceway.com.
The second round is the oh crap round.
Go inside their fight for the playoffs.
There's a big crash.
Fire on our right side here.
How do we get to the end of this race?
USA's Race for the Championship. Don't miss a new episode Thursday at 10 on USA and stream all the action of the season on Peacock.
No pressure, but it all comes down to this.
This one is for all the marbles. The whole enchilada. The kit and the caboodle.
I knew that was coming. I knew that was coming.
Capital One College Bowl, Friday on NBC.
Download the official app of NASCAR, and you can follow the action with free live scoring. There's in-car cameras and a radio broadcast. Search NASCAR in your app store, and you can download and start a free trial today. Right up against the wall, we knew they were going to be ripping the boards here in Miami, and that's what everyone has done. Larson has done it the best. He currently has a 5.4-second lead over Martin Truex Jr., who is running in the second spot. Then it's William Byron, Ryan Blaney, the two highest-running playoff drivers. Brad Keselowski having a good day, running in the fifth position. Chase Elliott, Ross Chastain, they've been fighting all day for the sixth spot, it seems like. Suarez, Logano are part of the top 10. And Kevin Harvick right there fighting as well. Marty, what's happening with the 24?
William Byron doing all he can to create some speed, Rick. And to that point, got on the wall a little while ago. And Steve, I love the conversation that ensued right after that. A spotter, Brandon Lyon, said, we'll move down the track a little bit so we can take pictures. And immediately, Rudy Fugel, his crew chief, came on the radio and said, nope, don't do that. Go back to the wall, run the wall, be aggressive. So I love the crew chief coaching his young driver to say, hey, don't get out of the game. Keep doing what you're doing.
Well, Rudy has found success here. That's where kind of Rudy and Byron jumped on the scene. To together, right? They get paired together last year. They come down here in the spring in February, and boom, to victory lane they go. There was this belief. They had worked together before at the Truck Series, and it was obvious they had this rapport, and it carried right through. So no one, in my opinion, knows better that what William Byron needs more than Rudy Fugle. So that's a crew chief helping his driver, pushing whatever buttons he thinks his driver needs. Some need the reins pulled back a little. Some need a little encouragement.
As this race goes on and on, the wall in turn 3 and 4 gets darker and darker from various hits and scrapes. The tires seem to be rather durable today as compared to the Xfinity Series yesterday. When a driver hit the wall in the Xfinity car, we had a flat tire almost immediately. These tires seem to be able to handle it a little bit better. Also, I think that the body on the quarter panel kind of covers the top edge of the tire, so only the bottom of the tire with the cambered rear end suspension allows that to hit the wall, and seems to be a little more durable today as we take a look at a replay here.
And Chase Briscoe once again up there on the wall. Watch how loose he gets this time. That is a great save.
Always off of turn two. I wonder what it is about the transition there that's got the drive. It's really where we're seeing most of these guys lose the back of the car tremendously. Briscoe trying to fight as hard as he can because possibly he could get up there and beat Harrison Burton for the free pass.
And Harrison just got by Chris Buescher. Now Austin, now the 5 of Larson is trying to get by Buescher.
There you go. Buescher trying not to go one lap down. Probably going to happen. 7 to go in this stage. He's going to race him pretty hard. These are 2 non-playoff drivers. I think that's a playoff driver in that 5 of Larson. He might let him go, but now he may be racing him a little bit harder than he normally would. Larson's going to try to drive in here and clear him up the racetrack.
Stays down low, so the momentum back in the hands of Buescher. We'll see if he can get back to him. He doesn't.
Amazing what that 5 car could do in the middle of the corner. Drive in on the bottom, stop turn, and exit turn 2 low and still keep pace. Not give up a ton of momentum in the middle of the corner.
All right, so that's really the question for me, right? We knew the 5 was good at running the top. We talked about it before the race, but Burton, what I see is not just Kyle Larson running the top. I see Kyle Larson driving a 5 car that could work middle, bottom and top of this racetrack. That has to be disheartening to all of the competitors.
Well, you're going to have to, because nobody's going to give him the top. I mean, you know, as good as he is, you know, they're going to make him go somewhere else. Even as he's lapped these cars, you see he's behind Harrison. Harrison's not going to let him go around the outside of him. He's going to make him pass him on the bottom. And, Bush right here.
14, I don't know if he has a flat tire, but heavy
left
smoke.
Left rear, look out how the...
Caution out.
That car looks like the profile's pretty bad, or the platform's pretty bad. Hard to tell what's going on.
Oh, man. A lot of smoke coming out of both sides. The front end.
Yeah, something is flat or failed on the back of this car. I don't know if it's the right rear, but it's definitely tipped up. The whole nose is up in the air.
Yeah. See, there's no letters on the left rear. Must have spun the car around or something.
Something broke, he said. I don't know.
Well, he's in.
He's talking about the steering right there, guys.
There's contact on the right front. He's got some right front damage. I think he's actually spun this car out somewhere.
He's been fighting an exceptionally loose race car. Every time we show him, he's had his hands full.
Yeah. Might have got loose, hit with the right rear, right front. Let's take a look. So there he is, back here around the start of the corner. Sideways right there. Pow! Front first into the wall. That'll do it.
Yeah, that's why the steering's no good anymore.
Yeah, we talked about approved and unapproved. This would be an unapproved hit. This is going to be big damage to this launch.
One of the bottom bikes here right now. We're in the wall hard here. Keep coming.
Yeah, that's just Chase Briscoe, you know, falling through the field, trying to make something out of nothing. And, you know, he's had some really good finishes lately. Been clawing them out. Not really running that great during races, but finding a way to finish races well. But today, they've got a huge hurdle to overcome right here.
This week, when we talked to all the drivers about, you know, Larson and Reddick being really good here, he waved his hand. Hey, look at me, man. I like this place. I run really good here. Felt like he could come here and contend.
If he goes to the garage, he's out of the race. And that's what it sounded like, that they are going to take it into the garage. So the first playoff driver that has terminal issues here at Miami.
Heard the radio rule change by NASCAR. Control arm can't change it on pit road. They know you got to change the toe link, but they don't want to change all these suspension parts. So broke an upper control arm or a lower control arm. You hey, if we go to the garage, we're going to be done. Yes, you. That is factual. If you go behind that pit wall, your day is over on the damaged vehicle policy. But you can't change a control arm on pit road. So unless you could go on the racetrack with whatever damage is in there and meet minimum speed, your day is over. I know this is an emotional battle. You're trying to not want the day to be over. But if the control arm is broken, you cannot change it on pit road.
We saw some crew members running to the garage. They're going to have to run back over here to find out what is wrong and what they can fix on the 14. Sunday night football on NBC and Peacock. The Dolphins host the Steelers. That's just up the road in Miami Gardens. Coverage beginning with Football Night in America at 7 p.m. Eastern. Dolphins are honoring the 72 championship team tonight. The 50th anniversary of that perfect 17-0 season. Junior, you're going to be on the show with Jack and Rodney. We all get to go hang out on the sidelines and enjoy a little football. You're, I'm sure, very happy your Commanders won today.
Yeah, hopefully they're going to talk some highlights, which I have not seen yet. Yeah, I can't wait to watch some winning highlights by the Washington Commanders.
Hey, Marty, I got an update for you, buddy. Carolina, 21.
I don't know if I want it, Steve. I'm in the tanking mode right now. Tank for the number one pick.
You didn't do a very good job at tanking. 21-3 Carolina.
Oh, my.
Beat your guy, Tom Brady. How about that for the Panthers?
Oh, this is just disheartening for Chase Briscoe. So, basically, just review it. Accident, hits the wall, comes down. He's on the damaged vehicle policy, comes to pit road. There is specific suspension parts you can't change, upper or lower control arm. NASCAR changed the rule to be safer for the crew members because it was starting to get carried away on pit road. Toe link is still acceptable. They have more damage than that. There's no option. You've wrecked. What needs to be repaired to make minimum speed cannot be repaired. So therefore, while you want to work on it, there, it doesn't matter. You are out of the race. So Chase Briscoe, high hopes heading into the day, and he's going to leave in a must-win situation, I would imagine, heading to Martinsville.
Yeah, so unfortunate for Chase Briscoe. Getting all the way now to the round of eight. That's the furthest he's ever been. Ross Chastain, William Byron, Chase Briscoe, and Christopher Bell all in the round of eight for the very first time in their careers. As we see the green and white checkered flag coming out, that means that Kyle Larson will sweep stage one and stage two. It's the eighth time that he has swept the first two stages of a race. And he's only gone on to win twice in that scenario. Swept Miami stages back in 2017, but finished third to Martin Truex Jr. when he won the championship. Let's check back in with Kyle Petty on the Peacock Pit Box. And KP, risk reward. We talked about it after stage one. How about now? It seems like the intensity's picking up again.
Yeah, the intensity's picking up. And we saw it there with Chase Briscoe. Put in a position where he had to make something happen. He only had a few laps, but you overdrive. Something gets out from under you. And now the reward is he's in the garage area. He gets to go home early. That's it. That's a tough place to be. We still see Christopher Bell on the struggle bus. Denny Hamlin is trying to get off that thing. Ross Chastain is off. I think this is going to be a great segment, a great last stage for Chastain.
And we had talked, Rick. Chase Elliott in the sixth position is doing a really nice job maintaining that track position, but I think all of us up here agree we haven't seen anything special enough out of that nine car that if he did have an issue on pit road, I'm not sure he could recover. So execution for Chase Elliott going to be key. See Chase Briscoe going to take the mandatory ride to the infield care center.
Anytime you get out of the car, you have to do that. And now cars making their way onto pit road, Kim.
And a fourth place finish in that stage for Ryan Blaney, top left. He said he was better this run, just a little free in three and four. So they're going to give him a little more rear security as well as a little more turn with an air pressure adjustment on those four fresh Goodyears. And Sunoco Fuel is Chase Elliott in front of you, Dave.
He gives up sixth position, Kim. He just needs it to work better on the wall in turns one and two. Four and fuel for him, Marty.
Kyle Larson in his pit stall early because he had that huge lead on pit road. Easily, he'll win the race off of pit road. He said he made wall contact, quote, decently twice. His teammate William Byron, 17 critical stage points in the bank already, said he needs more rear grip late in the run.
So many positive vibes have come from Miami, drivers winning championships, but there's also the negative, and that's what Chase Briscoe has suffered here at Miami, as he's now out of this race and will have to fight to get to the championship four next week. NASCAR on NBC is brought to you by Progressive. Revving up the savings on home and auto insurance, visit progressive.com. And by T-Mobile, more 5G bars in more places. Today's race recap is built by Northern Tool and Equipment. William Byron, after winning the pole, brought them to the green flag with Christopher Bell right there next to him.
Yeah, exciting year for the 1 and the 11. The excitement continues here in Miami, beating and banging, a little pushing and shoving down the straightaway.
It was Kyle Larson early on who was able to steal the lead away from the 24 of William Byron.
Yeah, and it was clean and green until the 45 of John Hunter Nemechek, who was filling in for the suspended Bubba Wallace. Loose off turn two, spins around, light contact. Car was able to continue.
On pit road, it was a close call for Denny Hamlin coming off. The 77 slides right there and then almost into the back of the five. So Denny Hamlin, tough getting off of pit road.
And then most recently, our first playoff driver out of the race, Chase Briscoe, loose in the middle of one and two. Big correction, heavy wall contact, some too much damage to the suspension. Repairs can't be made. He had to take his car to the garage.
First playoff driver out of this race as we take a look at the playoff standings brought to you by Xfinity. Again, Joey Logano comfortable because of the win a week ago. No one else comfortable, although William Byron has gained the most points of the playoff drivers in the first two stages.
Yeah, and that accident's going to put Chase Briscoe in a must-win, and Christopher Bell in seventh. Him and Chase Briscoe, the only two playoff drivers without stage points today, and you can see it right here, both 40 and 49 behind.
Get a few updates before the green flag comes back out on the final stage. We'll start with Kim.
And as you saw there on that playoff leaderboard, Ryan Blaney below the elimination line. And when I talked with the team this morning, they said they would not feel safe headed into Martinsville with anything but a win. But to get that win, they're going to be chasing Larson like everyone else. Here's what the team told Blaney in relation to what they saw the five doing.
It makes you feel any better. The five car, who's got really, really good speed, is really struggling in lap traffic. He can't run the bottom to pass anybody, so he's kind of welded to the wall as well.
And then Blaney added to the team, the weak point he feels like is his entry into turn one. He can't roll with speed into it, so that's what he's going to work on this final stage, Dave.
Did Chase Elliott's team adjust his race car to be a winning race car? That remains to be seen. One thing that did happen, the pit crew did its job. They picked him up one spot, Marty.
How about Denny Hamlin's pit crew? Rough first stop of the day. They gained him three on this last stop of the day, though. And Chris Gavehart had a conversation with Hamlin about which lane to choose on the restart. Listen.
It feels like we're getting bottled up on the bottom there, or not having enough momentum to finish and get formed on the top. I don't know if you're feeling the same way or just situational, but that's what we see up here. So just keep that in mind on this next one.
Restarts have been a topic for Hamlin all day long. Can he get a good one here at a critical time? We'll find out, Rick.
About to find out as we will have 97 laps remaining in this race. Again, one of the questions will be, how many stops will you make in the final stage? One or two, that is the option. It's Larson and now Truex Jr. making up row one as we get the final stage underway. A lot of momentum for the five of Kyle Larson, and he shuts the door on William Byron, who was working a little higher line.
William Byron had a ton of speed through one and two. Let's see if he can do the same thing in three and four. In the gas, trying to get on the outside of Larson. Larson, too much speed on the bottom.
Almost four wide for third back there. Ryan Blaney was on the inside, and just behind him, the 11 of Denny Hamlin on the move up to fourth.
We got a Denny Hamlin siding in the top five and a little front run speed here, early run speed in this 11 car. They've struggled on fire off. He's asked for them to help his race car. Looks like they're making it work. The 9 and the 19 almost contact and in the fence off of two. Real hard racing there.
19 using that momentum. Right in the middle of the racetrack, trying to pull in front of the 9 of Chase Elliott.
Again, that early run speed in the Penske car, too. Hanging tight on the back of this 24 and the 5. Blaney right there in the yellow car to the inside. Got to take advantage of that while you have pace in the car on the first few laps of the run.
Byron all the way up to the fence, going through 1 and 2 that last time through. And we'll see if it works out for him. Now to the bottom of the racetrack, and right behind him will be Blaney.
Look at that the 12 car roll around the bottom. 24 slides up the racetrack side by side off of turn four down the front straightaway. Staying away from each other so there's no side draft.
Blaney able to make the bottom of the racetrack work. We'll see if he can complete the pass through one and two.
As we get further and further in this race, guys, I think this 12 fires off better and better and better. We get a short run late in this race. He's got the track position. That could be a way for him to get to victory lane. The 11 of Denny now trying to fend off the 19, his teammate.
The two Joe Gibbs Racing drivers fighting for the same spot. Denny Hamlin in the playoffs. Martin Truex Jr. is not. Marty.
Well, think about the turn of events for Denny Hamlin over the last 15 minutes or so, Rick. The terrific pit stop by the pit crew. And here's Hamlin going for third as well. We talked about how critical this restart would be. And keep this in mind, Rick, as he gets that position, maybe from William Byron. Denny Hamlin has been the best car by far on long runs, maybe even better than Kyle Larson. So these early spots could be critical.
This 24 is had some issues being too tight. As this race goes on, the track's going to get tighter. They are not staying ahead of this racetrack. He's losing track. He's losing positions right here in front of us. Fighting this car on the early run is William Byron.
And the most recent incident coming out was Chase Briscoe into the wall and out of the car. He's now standing by with Dave.
Just stepped out of the medical center. Chase, were you chasing the same thing all day long, or what was that happening there at the end?
Yeah, it was weird. You know, we were really, really tight kind of the whole race, and it was really good on the long run, just too tight on the short run. So that green flag run, trying to get on the other side of it, was just extremely, extremely loose. I was hanging on kind of every lap there, those last 5 or 10, and knew we weren't going to get the lucky dog. It was honestly just kind of cruising, trying to get to the caution there in a couple laps, and went into the one, and I mean, it was like I hit ice. So yeah, frustrating. I think that's the first time I've ever just crashed by myself, so embarrassing on that side. And of all the time for it to happen, that's not when we needed it to happen. So yeah, just know what we got to do next week now. It was obviously a struggle to kind of pass the first race, and we'll open up our strategy a little bit now for next week. So yeah, it's kind of going to learn to try to win, but yeah, everybody says that they're all frustrated for the guys, but I'm definitely frustrated just because there's something that they had nothing to do with there. That was 100% on me, so got to get better.
Martinsville is his next shot, guys.
100% on him that he got the car in the wall because he was pushing hard, but his car did not have the grip it needed to have. And yes, he did wreck the car, but the team has to give him a better car, right, and be able to take the fight to these guys, and just did not have it today.
Daniel Suarez right there in the 99 in seventh place, trying to look around the Hendrick duo of Chase Elliott and William Byron, sixth and fifth position. They're right on the back bumper, the 19 of Truex. Great action right here down into turn one and two. Marty, what you got on the 24 here struggling?
About to lose another spot, Junior, and you're spot on. The car just way too tight for William Byron early in the run here. In fact, came on the radio a second ago as his teammate Chase Elliott looks underneath him, said just plowing tight early in this run.
Yeah, and that'll get worse because this track's just going to get tighter. It ain't going to get looser. You have to keep working on that race car, find a way to give him fire off speed. We've seen some teams do it. This 11 car, Denny Hamlin, took off on this restart. They've improved his car really, really tight on the early runs for him early in the race.
Chase Elliott up to the fifth spot now as the 24 continues to fall back.
Yeah, the hope is he can maintain. Try not to lose too many positions here. Get a chance to work on this car again.
Suarez running in front of his teammate right now, Ross Chastain. But the 99 also trying to take a position away from Byron, and he gets that spot.
Yeah, the trackhouse drivers leapfrog his teammate, Ross Chastain. Now working his way into the top 10, trying to find his way into the top 5 around Chase Elliott for that position.
We saw just how tough Daniel Suarez was at the Roval. He lost power steering and fought that race car, almost 4,000-pound race car, for so many laps before they were able to help him out a little bit by adding some steering fluid. But it was a tough battle, but it ended up eliminating him from the playoffs in the round of 12.
Impressed to be able to see what that car can do on the bottom of the racetrack, making good pace down there. Really the only one doing that down there on the racetrack this late into the run.
Larson out front. We've seen that almost all day. 145 laps led, and
an issue the 11
slow on the racetrack.
Looks like he's back up to speed. I don't know if he got loose in the middle of one and two. Let's take a look. Watch him in this 11 car down into turn one. Sideways.
Oh, yeah.
Wow. Whoa. And the right rear gets straightened out by the wall. And almost spins it around again. Huge moment.
We're on up. Now, well, just take this up.
You know, so they've got that car freed up. We talked about them adjusting the car to get it to where it'll turn. Everything's fine. Regroup, get going again. But what kind of damage did he do to that right rear tire for the long run?
Well, the thing, keep in mind that as the sun's starting to set, that turns one and two is starting to get shaded. And now that that could change the way the car drives over there, you may not may need to go back on some of those adjustments.
Let's hide in the attic.
No, in the basement. Why can't we just get in the running car?
Are you crazy? Let's hide behind the chainsaws.
Smart. Yeah, okay.
If you're in a horror movie, you make poor decisions. That's what you do.
Shh, I'm being quiet. Breathing on me.
If you want to save even more, you bundle your home and car insurance with Geico. It's what you do.
Crafts, sporting goods, restaurants, and the future of NASCAR all from your neighborhood. DoorDash.
If you're loud, be louder. If you stand out, stand strong. And if you got the devil on your shoulder, take him for a ride.
Our internet isn't ideal.
My dad made the brilliant move to get us T-Mobile home internet.
Oh.
Which... we have to share our signal with the entire neighborhood.
Yeah, now we do some weird things to get our speeds.
Well, I'm up.
Come on, kids.
This sucks.
Well, if you just switch, maybe you don't have to be
there. Whoa.
Yeah.
Okay, yikes.
Oh, sorry. I wasn't thinking.
We don't really use the V-word.
Kind of insensitive.
Yeah.
We prefer pro-lunar.
Yes, much better.
Together from every corner of the globe.
This is unbelievable!
In pursuit of the one reward that sets the special few apart. The title of World Champion. Don't miss racing's ultimate coronation. The Breeders' Cup World Championships on NBC USA and streaming on Peacock.
Under 80 laps to go. The NASCAR Cup Series playoffs on NBC. This telecast presented by T-Mobile. I want to take a look at the Ruoff Mortgage keys to victory lane.
Yeah, one or two stops. This last stage, the longest stage, when I only need to stop once for fuel. There's a little bit of data that says you stop twice for tires, you can have a faster run overall.
When will we see the cautions? It's one thing to say, hey, we're going to pit on the green on this lap, but it takes one caution at the wrong time to mess your whole day up.
Larson's been out there a half a second faster in the field banging the boards. Can anybody get up there and find the pace that he has and bring the fight to this five car?
I want to go through the field, and we'll start with Marty.
Kyle Larson so impressive today. He's led all but 36 laps here at Miami, and Cliff Daniels had an interesting conversation with him under the last caution. He said, listen to me, the track is going to go through a transition during this next run. Keep that in mind this entire run. Tell me what the car needs, because we need to adjust to the racetrack or we may not win this thing, Kim.
Ryan Blaney currently running in the second position, and Dale Junior noted what good fire off speed they've had. Well, that has been their clutch here today, and they knew that before they even started this race. I checked in with the team, and they said, we have great short run speed, feel really good about it. We just need to maintain during the long run. That hasn't been where we were strong this weekend. So hoping that they get a caution late in the race so that Blaney can use that good fire off speed, and they can take advantage of of the short run. Martin Truex Jr. running right behind him in the third position. Still with us on the season for the number 19 team. And I asked them today, have they come to terms with the fact that they may go winless on the season? And crew chief James Small told me that is not even in our psyche. We have not thought about that. We have three more races this year that we can potentially win. And today is just as good a shot as anybody. Right now, just a little bit free, Dave, on the 19 car.
Things are looking up right now for Chase Elliott, and he's been running so close to the wall. Look at that. Alan Gustafson, his crew chief, told me we didn't do that much in practice because we weren't very good. I said, has he run well there in the past? He said, oh, yeah, as recently as 2020 when we got blocked and then passed for the win. So Chase is very comfortable up there, but he's got to take care of the car during the day and then look at the data that he collects before he really starts charging up there. And Marty, looks like he's doing it now.
Dave's save of the day goes to Denny Hamlin. I would say they freed that car up for Hamlin. Now the question is, how good will it be on the long run, which has really been their strength all evening long or all day long. Denny Hamlin hasn't said a word after that near wreck a moment ago, Kim.
Joey Logano running in the sixth position. They have been working on their long run speed throughout the course of this race, trying to get it better. They feel good about the short run speed. And despite not being up front throughout the race, they still have a goal of winning this race. They said the benefit of winning here today, despite already being locked in the championship four, is it keeps every other playoff team from getting their focus on Phoenix, Marty.
Kim, Daniel Suarez coming back to the track where he won an Xfinity Series championship. And he told me earlier this week, I feel so at home in Miami. And I would say so. Right now, the best running track house car just in front of his teammate, Ross Chastain. He's saying the car a little bit too tight early in the run, Kim.
And too tight for Chastain as well. Just needs more turn in a kind of a surprise race for Chastain. He's been so good at intermediate. Thought he was going to lead laps here today. Only has grabbed two stage points currently right now. In the plus on the playoff leaderboard, but is going to have some work to do to make sure he maintains that spot come Martinsville, Marty.
Kevin Harvick at Miami, and Miami, Kim, where he won a title, and he also leads all drivers in top fives, top tens, and average finish, showing why he's so good at this racetrack. They, too, very good on the longer run. He's been in the top 10 all day long. William Byron back as far as he's been all day long. In the 10th position, car extremely tight. Listen to the radio.
Man, it's terrible. Yelling about plowing. We just gotta survive somehow, buddy. Do all you can for me.
Steve, Rudy Fugel trying to keep his driver in the game, telling him, hey, stick with it. But the car, a handful for Byron right now.
Yeah, well, still 72 laps to go in the race. You know, he knows the car's not good. And you look at the points, as Byron loses positions, he closes in on that cut line, currently plus five over Blaney, same over Hamlin. So bad time to have a bad run, but only a few laps away. If you're going to stop twice, Rick, just past lap 200, we may see green flag pit stops when we return to Miami.
Verizon Frontline is built for those we all rely on. Built to prioritize first responders. Built for extreme conditions. Built for America's most reliable 5G network. Because when seconds count and lives are on the line, the people we rely on need technology they can rely on. Verizon is the number one network choice in public safety. Verizon Frontline, the advanced network and technology for first responders.
Sonic's 2-for-5 menu, you get two delicious things for only $5. How will you know which two to choose? Don't ask us. That's a rhetorical question. And everyone knows 2-for-5 is better than one, which is helpful if you struggle with decision making. The Sonic 2-for-$5 menu.
Sonic.
This book
has helped me reach so many young homeowners who have become their parents.
Hey, what's the lowest you'll go on one of these mugs?
Well, remember, no haggling in stores.
Chapter 6, yep.
They may have read the book, but they still have a long way to go.
I was hoping to get your John Hancock on there.
Let's just call it a signature.
I noticed there weren't any refreshments, so I'm just going to leave a couple of snackies.
Folks, the line's a shambles. Let's tuck it in.
Sir?
Come on. Come on.
Okay.
Oh, right.
Progressive can't protect you from becoming your parents, but we can protect your home and auto when you bundle with us.
Okay, we don't need a line monitor.
Do you feel it? There's something in the air in Miami. And in Pittsburgh, a new era is just beginning. Steelers, Dolphins, Sunday night.
We're going to get our kids back.
This goes so much deeper than you know.
Oh my God, they're everywhere.
Larson, now an 8.2 second lead, and we look at the drivers that are separated by 12 points on either side of the cut line for that championship four. Ross Chastain, 12 points right now ahead of the cut line. William Byron, he's plus four, and the two guys below it, Blaney and Denny Hamlin, right now fighting to find those points. Remember, every position on the racetrack is a point. Marty.
Hey, Rick, so we've talked about this two-stop versus one-stop strategy. Denny Hamlin debating that right now. William Byron's team as well. But, hey, Stevens, you're Chris Rebell's team. You're Adam Stevens. Right now you're 35 below the cut line. Would you not throw a Hail Mary here and say, hey, we're going to do it in two stops. Maybe we'll drag other people with us.
Well, I would say they need to do a Hail Mary, but I don't know if two stops is the Hail Mary. I think Richmond, while it looks nothing like Miami, has the same sort of tire wear, and we saw a lot of guys just chase the math. The math says pit in about 32, 33 laps on your tires, pit again in 33 laps. While it seems like having an extra pit stop is crazy, Rick, old tires are so slow. The extra laps on the new tires make up more time. Basically, it's a math equation. It's 5 to 8 seconds faster to pit twice. The negative, you're a lap down for a pretty good chunk, and it's easy for a lot of points, which all the playoff guys need, to slip away very quickly. So we're going to see who does what, Dave.
So, Steve, I had that conversation with Adam Stevens this morning, and he really wouldn't jump at the two-stop strategy right away, and I kind of pressed him, and he goes, no, I just don't see a lot of time there. However, we have to run the race first. I have to see what the speed fall-off is during the run. I don't feel like I have to really throw a, quote, Hail Mary. So we'll see what they do, but based on where his points were, that wasn't the strategy he was definitely going to adhere to begin with.
So, Rick,
Marty?
Oh.
Yeah, William Byron is right in front of him. I can tell you he wants to do two stops. Rudy Fugel told him a moment ago, give me a couple of more here, Steve. So he's going to have him run about four more laps. But William Byron struggling. Now he's back in 13th. He desperately wants to get to pit road.
So the magic number is if you feel you can run 60 laps on fuel, that's when you want to pit on a two-stop strategy, because if you get caught by a yellow, you could then take the wave around, right? Like, so I know this sounds silly, but these crew chiefs aren't thinking one move ahead on this chessboard. They're two, three, four. They're like, all right, if I move this piece, what is everybody else going to do? And say the caution does come out. Say I'm just unlucky. Have I put myself in a corner to end my day? Or do I still have an escape plan? You know, the best, smartest minds in the world, they don't get into any sort of mix of anything without knowing their way out. That's what these crew chiefs are trying to do right here. So I would imagine one or two more laps, and we're going to see what the decisions are by the leaders.
And if you're Larson, do you set your own strategy, or do you go off of your competitors that are closest to you?
With a 9-second lead, I'm really concerned about the top five. Right now, he might have his own planes, but don't let Truex, Blaney, Elliott, or Hamlin get track position on me, because they have pretty good cars. I'm not sure I could pass them back. Guys back farther in the field, I'm not stressed about those guys. It's the one right behind me, isn't it? Nope, I think he's going to come right here. So we're getting ready to see some action real quick if pit road opens. But to your point, with a 9-second lead, you can run that extra lap. You can take a deep breath, see who you're really, you know, racing or who you're not racing. The 24 looks low on the track. I would say this is pit entry angle for the 24. There you go. Left-hand turn for William Byron. The faucet has opened. We will see if any other teams want to counter William Byron's move to come in. It's clear what his strategy is now. He'll bring this car to the attention of Rudy Fugel, and more importantly, some adjustments. A car that ran up front earlier has fallen outside the top 10 with 61 to go. This could be an important adjustment, Marty, for the 24.
pitted from 14th, Steve, and not quite to 60 to go, 61 to go, but William Byron couldn't handle it any longer. And the thing that's amazing to me is the massive swing this car went through. We played the radio earlier about how tight he was. He could barely drive it because it was so loose at the end of the run. You see cars continuing on the racetrack, and that's the question. How many follow William Byron? And he has to back up. Look at that. They're going to have to tighten the left front. They have to jack it up, Steve. You have to get that wheel nut on while it's up. And now he killed the car. Now he stalled it, fires it back up. A disastrous pit stop for William Byron.
Take all that math on your notebook, crumple it up, and throw it in the paper, Rick. It doesn't matter what strategy you're on. If it takes 25 or 30 seconds to put four tires on the car, there's no winning strategy that can overcome that. We'll just have to see how it plays out, Kim.
The 22 of Joey Logano already locked into the championship round at Phoenix. He said, I need more drive off. They didn't make an air pressure adjustment on them. And look, problem here, another green flag stop problem. So again, slow green flag stops for the teams we've seen to pit so far. Four tires, no go fuel for Logano.
Now if I'm a crew chief waiting to call my crew in, I'm scared to death. Two guys, two bad stops. All right, guys, take a deep breath. Nothing special here. Let the strategy work out. We don't have to press. Sometimes pitting under green, you think you need to try harder. This is the one that's going to gain the attention. Now Blaney and Chase Elliott have come to pit road. It'll be decision time for the five, but first pit stops, Kim.
And they told the team, make a clean stop. They paid attention to what happened. This was their goal all day long. Have clean stops every single stop. Blaney just needs more grip in the rear over the long run. Air pressure doesn't it, Dave, for Ryan Blaney.
Can we get a clean stop here for Chase Elliott? Good on the right side, around to the left side. Now Chase hit his marks perfectly. Sunoco fuel going in. That looked pretty good.
Yeah, Dave, I agree. Very good. Great execution by the nine. So now we see Ross Chastain smoking the right front, trying to get to pit road.
And Ross has been complaining about front turn. He just doesn't have any on either end of the racetrack. They did take an air pressure adjustment. Four tires, Sunoco fuel for Ross Chastain. As you see, Martin Truex Jr. there at the bottom finishing his stop. And Blaney looks like has an issue. Spin.
Sorry, guys.
We talked about the access road. It looks like the 12 of Ryan Blaney leaving pit road spun on the access road, trying to get too much. Kyle Larson still on the racetrack. I think the first thing is let's see what happens with Blaney. But then, Rick, we'll have to take a couple laps, let scoring work out and see who is lucky by this caution and who gets hurt by it.
Larson was on his way to pit road when this happened. He was slowing down, and so the second the caution came out, he stayed out on the racetrack.
You know, Rick, I'd rather be lucky than good, but in the perfect world, you're both. And that might just be both for Kyle Larson today. We'll see how scoring works. But how about the 12? This is the 12 signature. Great cars that can't get to the finish of the races. Once again, last week, it was a spin on the racetrack. This week, guys, I didn't see it firsthand, but it looked like it was still on the access road for the 12 car.
Well, we talked about it earlier, Steve, how important it is to have good pace leaving, but there's very little grip down there. It's dirty, doesn't get blown off. A lot of dust gets piled up on top of that. Go back and see if that's what happened. But if it did, I mean, I've almost done it. I've almost come off of there and, you know, in the gas really hard and get the right side tires on the wrong side, get it in the grass, and then you're along for the ride.
Yeah, once you drop a tire off in the grass, there's pretty much nothing you could do. We're going to take a look and see how it happened. There he is, far right of the screen. He gets loose.
Wow.
That was wild. Came around fast.
That is weird.
So it didn't look like he dropped the tire, but I think NASCAR had a big concern about him maybe sliding into the apron or up the racetrack even and needed to throw this yellow. I got no problem with that. Even though he does get going again, just the danger of that car going across the racetrack was enough for me to get the yellow out. Free pass.
I'm slide up there, man. I don't know. I'm not shaking.
Free pass is going to go to the 22 of Logano, we're being told by NASCAR. A lot of cars that are one lap down that had just come to pit road. So, Steve, we're going to see them do the wave around, I'm guessing.
If they've already pitted. The real question, though, is the 19 of Martin Truex Jr. and the 1 of Ross Chastain currently on the scoring monitor. They have pitted and are on the lead lap because they were on pit road or had yet to really blend when the caution comes out. So what happens is you come down pit road, you get into your pit stall, the leader, he stays on the racetrack, he's going to come lap you. But then the caution comes out, so the leader lifts off the gas, he slows down. So now you're losing less time to the leader. So then you are either scored at the start-finish relative to the leader, or if your pit stall's on the second half of pit road, it's to pit out. So we kind of have to untangle this web of where those cars are pitted. If Truex and Chastain are on the lead lap, then they will stay out and they will assume the front row. So it could be a huge break for Martin Truex Jr. in a year where he doesn't seem to be getting any lucky breaks. And I believe that's the case because pit road's now open as we see Kyle Larson turn to the bottom. So Truex and Chastain will take the front row, but first it's about pit stops and hopefully a clean stop for these cars coming to pit road.
And the first one that will see action, Dave.
Christopher Bell's team was committed to a one-stop strategy in the stage. They can get to the end with fuel from here, so we'll see what happens. They have, obviously, tires left. Christopher said, I need to roll the center better, Marty.
Ooh, Kyle Larson was so close, Dave, to coming to pit road there. Got back out on the racetrack. He actually asked Cliff Daniels, did we hurt ourselves in that process? Cliff said, nope, you're still the leader car. Very good for him. For Denny Hamlin, he said the car was tight, but once he lost that rear grip and slid up the racetrack, he said, I lost all the rear at that moment. And then he said, the biggest thing we have to do is be good on the short run.
So the question will be, now, Martin Truex Jr., Ross Chastain, can they stay in front of Larson? Maybe this is an opportunity.
Jeff on USA.
That was so much fun watching Jeff Burton take AJ Styles around the racetrack and how Corey LaJoie and AJ Styles both experiencing each other's world. It's all happening on USA's Welcome to My World, NASCAR meets WWE.
All right, Rick, so as we talked about, this is a great show, a shot of Corey LaJoie's car right there. Having a decent day, currently in the 21st position, good run for the 7. All right, a couple different players behind this pace cam from Coca-Cola. You see the 1 of Ross Chastain on the bottom, the 19 of Martin Truex Jr. Here's basically what happened. They came to pit road under green flag pit stops. While on pit road, the yellow comes out. Larson, slowing down, actually was slowing down to come to pit road as well, never laps these two cars. So they're like, hit the perfect time to pit because of the reduced speed in the field. They service their cars. They return to the track on the lead lap. So when the lead lap cars pit, they just stay out. And now they're the front row, right? You see Kyle Larson in 3rd, Hamlin in 4th, Harvick in 5th. All of those cars pitted under the caution. They had yet to make their green flag pit stop. One other note, and it's a real small thing. I thought it was going to be a big deal, but you see Joe Logano in 13th. He was the free pass. The 9 of Chase Elliott took the wave around. It really is just a little bit of track position. What you need to know if you're a Chase Elliott fan, and there's a lot of them out there, your man's all right. He came under green. He took the wave around. He's on the lead lap in 14th. Really, all the playoff cars are still in the lead lap other than Chase Briscoe back in 36, who's out of the race.
And, Steve, they don't have to stop again. Only 52 laps to go.
They don't have to stop again, but I'm going to tell you, these tires are going to be slippery if they have to run all 52 on one set.
So it's Martin Truex Jr. and Ross Chastain who are the benefactors of the most recent caution as they were on pit road. We'll see if they can take advantage of it. Green flag back in the air. Three wide as Denny Hamlin tries to challenge on the bottom of the racetrack for the lead. Can he clear him? He does, coming out of 2. What a restart for Denny Hamlin.
And for the first time all day, that red and white number 5 of Kyle Larson isn't in clean air out front. We know he has a great car, but how will it be in traffic?
Kevin Harvick side drafting him. Harvick's trying to take the spot away from Larson.
That car you saw making that aggressive move on the back straightaway. A.J. Allmendinger all the way to up to 8th place here. Still battling on the inside of Austin Dillon. Harvick right in front of them. Tucks back in line. Battle for 2nd right here. 19 in the 1 car.
Well, they're side by side. We saw the 6 also of Brad Keselowski. He is up inside the top 5.
Denny way up the track right there. Remember this car, not quite handling perfectly for Denny early in these runs, but that clean air is going to really improve the grip in this 11 car.
Kyle Larson back there in 5th. This is the first time in a long time he's been behind other cars, so now his car drives completely different than it did before.
Goes to the bottom of the racetrack, can't get by Brad Keselowski.
He's going to try to wrap the bottom here. Brad's going to have the speed to try to clear him down the front straightaway. He does. Larson tried to side draft and slow him down just a little bit. Couldn't get it done. Now Brad chops him off down here into turn 1. defends any kind of move to the inside there.
Larson back up against the wall. What move will he make this time? Down to the bottom of the racetrack again this time. Keselowski doesn't chase him down there, but has the momentum in the middle of the racetrack.
Side by
and
side.
For the lead, here comes the 19. Martin Truex Jr. to the inside, side drafting the 11.
So this is the car that I thought was as good or maybe near as good as Kyle Larson. He's kind of had trouble getting that track position, but now he has it. This 19 car in the lead. Now the fight is for Larson to try to get up there and retake first position. Can he do it?
Martin Truex Jr. up front. He's led three laps today, trying to add to that right here, and the five right up against the fence.
He's pushing hard back there, Rick. He's got a great run on Brad down the front straightaway. Looks low here. Brad's going to fire it into the corner so he can't slide job or do anything like that on entry. Going to be side by side here off of turn two. Brad's going to run him tight.
Up the racetrack, the five goes close.
Yeah, but Larson's got forward momentum into turn three. Watch what he does with it. Drives it to the bottom. Is he going to stay on the bottom? He does. Trying to be in the gas, hoping to hear clear. He is clear.
Right in front of him, side by side. Chastain, Denny Hamlin for second place.
Seems like all season long, these two have been side by side fighting for position, and Chastain takes the spot away from Denny Hamlin.
Now the five trying to top the top around the six. He's going to do it. Larson down the back straightaway. He's going to have the momentum on Brad on the high side. Finally getting that position. He sets it right on the wall there on entry. Gasses it up right here. Look at him move forward. Just an inch away, if not hitting the wall at times.
And a great turn for the six of Brad Keselowski, able to stay almost with Larson.
Oh,
and now he comes down and Keselowski was there.
Yeah, he knew Brad was there, too. They got side mirrors on the driver's side. They could see what's going on there. He chopped Brad off into that corner. Brad's probably not real happy with that.
So Larson up to fourth. It's Truex, Chastain, Hamlin, Larson, Keselowski. This was how close it was.
Wow.
Larson chops him and then continues to come down the racetrack in front of the six to take all the air away. Now the five, Larson trying to get the 11.
Closing in on Denny Hamlin, but it's Martin Truex Jr. out in front here in Miami.
In the future, everything will be powered by renewable energy, but it's not as easy as flipping a switch. It's a long road requiring decades of time and trillions of dollars. But what if there was a better direction on the path to zero carbon emissions? An energy source that's available right now, that's affordable, plentiful, and environmentally friendly. There is, and it's propane. Get the facts at propane.com/now.
Get crafts, sporting goods, restaurants, and the future of NASCAR all from your neighborhood. DoorDash.
Hey, guys! Let's do it!
Protect your truck with laser-measured WeatherTech floor liners in the front.
Fits perfect!
And rear. Underseat storage system. No drill mud flaps. The tech liner to protect the bed and tailgate. Bump step to guard the rear bumper. And the cup phone to secure your phone.
Yes! Guys?
Order your American-made products at WeatherTech.com.
We get out, fired up, hook big ones. We get out and rip it, and we track them down. So crack a Mountain Dew, get out and do.
Our internet isn't ideal.
My dad made the brilliant move to get us T-Mobile home internet.
Oh,
which... we have to share our signal with the entire neighborhood.
Yeah, now we do some weird things to get our speeds.
Well, I'm up.
Come on, kids.
This sucks.
Well, if you just switch, maybe you don't have to be there.
Whoa.
Yeah, okay. Yikes.
Oh, sorry. I wasn't thinking.
We don't really use the V word.
Kind of insensitive.
Yeah.
We prefer pro-lunar.
Yes, much better.
Martinsville,
Isn't it charming? But don't be fooled. This half mile of mayhem is looking to rob four drivers of their championship dreams.
It's a must-win situation.
Time is now, boys. Tick tock. The NASCAR playoffs continue at Martinsville on NBC.
Fire! 38 laps to go. It's NASCAR Cup Series playoffs on NBC. This telecast presented by T-Mobile. And now the 11, giving the fight back to the 5 of Larson, as we will have extended coverage on Peacock after the race, the NASCAR America post-race show. Make sure to stay with us for that.
These guys right here trying to sort this out. Larson wants to get clear so he can try to see about driving up to the top two. Chastain Truex out front running pretty much equal times, about a second apart. And then this battle right here.
Find that natural rhythm, and the speed is going to come your way. They're going to come back to you. Natural rhythm. Smooth.
Look at the move by the 11. Denny Hamlin dives to the bottom of the racetrack or the middle, trying to make it work. He gets beside the 5, but can't keep the momentum up.
AJ right there behind these two. Be a little patient in that 16 car. Real impressed with the fire off speed of the colleague car. Makes a lot of gains on restarts. Side by side down the front straightaway. He should get the position here, diving off into turn one.
AJ races these guys aggressively. He doesn't run every race. He will next year, but he does not give them any inch, not at all. That lap right there, Kyle Larson, 2/10 quicker than Truex, 3/10 quicker than Chastain. So Larson's car is just starting to fire off on this run. Let's see if he can run these guys down. 36 to go.
Big run by Blaney on the bottom of your screen in the 12 as he's trying to get by William Byron.
They're battling for 15th, Rick, back here in a miss. A lot of traffic in front of them. Look at two sliding around on the bottom of the racetrack.
And again, Larson 2/10 quicker. Blaney trying to work himself back up through this field. Remember, he got mired back in the field because of that spin on the access road.
These cars never seem to run as good after you spin them out. I mean, you know, the old cars recovered pretty well, but for whatever reason, this car here, I know plus the track position is a massive issue. You get back in 20th or worse, it's really hard to make up the ground. Reddick's had that fight all day long since his issues sitting in 25th.
As a driver, I never ran as good after I spun it out either. You know what I mean? I had to get myself going again. But there you go, Steve. You're showing the speed difference.
Oh, yeah. Kyle Larson is coming. 4/10 of a second a lap. The question is, how quickly can he get by the one, really, for me?
Oh, look here.
The 11 fighting back on Allmendinger. You see the 5 up in front of these two. Kim.
AJ Allmendinger having a great run today, currently in the 4th position, but they've battled handling issues all day long, have made that car better. It has bounced between tight and loose throughout the course of different runs, but AJ having a surge on the Cup side for colleague racing in the last 5 starts in the Cup Series. He has top 10 finishes, and I asked him, kind of, what does that do for you? Because you're going to be running full-time Cup again next year, and he said, you know, I would have done anything the team wanted me to do, and they wanted me to go to Cup, but for me, these finishes we've had recently have given me the confidence that I belong back in the Cup Series, Marty.
Kim, I think we're seeing the transition for Denny Hamlin. Got to the lead, gave up all those spots. They struggled with short run speed in the 11 car, but got back past AJ Allmendinger a moment ago, now in 4th. Chris Gabehart just told him a moment ago, now get into your rhythm. The 5 is going to, quote, be a bulldozer coming up through the field. Tag onto the back of him and follow him. And there he is, to his promise, trying to get second, Rick.
Around the outside, and we see the 1. Ross Chastain went into the middle of the racetrack. That opened the door for Kyle Larson, and he shot by. Now it's Martin Truex Jr. that he sets his sights on.
Remember, you can do this on.
And we heard the crew chief. He was trying to calm him down, saying, you know, get in your rhythm. Get in your rhythm because you know you can catch him.
Janice. got into you?
At Sunoco, we know how to fuel peak performance. We've been doing it for American racing for over 50 years. Fuel your best.
You spend the day watching your kids' big game. At least one of you is having fun. And Chop House Aioli is calling your name. You want crispy onion strings and a brioche bun. Everything's better with melted cheese. Kevin's dad doesn't understand boundaries. The Sonic Chop House Cheeseburger.
Sonic.
At SafeLight, we take care of vehicles with the latest technology. When my last customer discovered a crack in his car's windshield, he scheduled at SafeLight.com.
SafeLight makes it easy.
We're the experts at replacing your glass and recalibrating your advanced safety system.
And they recycled my old glass. Now that's a company I can trust.
Don't wait. Schedule today.
SafeLight Repair, SafeLight Replace.
Okay, we'd open with creaky footsteps. Scary music goes all intense.
The couple jumps up like,
what is that?
They scream, ah! And you go, it's the money you could save by bundling your home and car insurance! Money shoots out from drawers, vents from under the bed. The couple's screaming, ah!
Wait, wouldn't they be happy about the savings?
They're scared of how happy savings make them feel.
Course.
See how much you could save by bundling with Geico.
Drink them if you got them.
USA presents the perfect cocktail for a damn good time. Mix two parts celebrities, one part outrageous games, and a slice of fun.
Take your spanking. Come here.
Farmageddon. The games begin December 5th on USA.
The San Francisco earthquake.
We just need to figure out what you're here to do.
Help! Give me your hand.
This building's coming down. Look out! Wake up.
Kyle Larson running in the second position. He's been the dominant car all day. One stage one, one stage two, led 177 laps, but a caution came out at the wrong time for him, but the right time for Martin Truex Jr. So Martin Truex Jr. now has a 1.6 second lead over Kyle Larson. Can Larson catch him? And if he does, can he get past him, Marty?
Larson has ground to gain, Rick, but Cliff Daniels, his crew chief, trying to coach his driver on. Listen.
Remember, you can do this all day. They cannot do that. Smooth rhythm.
Got it.
The 19 is downshifting, and he is being really hard on his rears right now. That means to beat him, you take care of yours, and you keep your pace up. You're doing great.
Ever the cheerleader, Cliff Daniels, and what he's talking about is you can run that high line all day long. Nobody else can. Go attack. Go get him.
What I loved about it is the cheerleading wasn't cheerleading as much as it was coaching or being a general. Very to the point. Not that you're great. Not you're there. These are the facts. He's shifting. He's doing this. You must do this. 24 to go. He's laying a path of success out for Kyle Larson. But can Kyle put together the 24 laps in a year where he has self-admittedly made more mistakes than he really allows himself to make? It's what eliminated him for the playoffs, a mistake at the Roval. Can he run 24 clean laps, Kim? And can he run down that 19?
And on the flip side for the 19, they're intermittently getting on the radio and giving him updates on what Larson is doing with his lap times. Currently, Truex P1 in terms of lap times, Larson P2. So they came on the radio and said, you beat him that time. Otherwise, nothing on the radio from the 19. And they have great long run speed. In fact, they wanted it to, as we have a spin by Tyler Reddick.
Tyler Reddick into the wall hard with the front of this car, and it brings the caution out for the fifth time.
Yeah, big contact for the 8.
Tyler, you all right?
I think so.
A lot of damage to the front end.
We've seen you struggling with this car all day, really.
Again, off of turn two, where we've seen some drivers with some issue. Looks like a little bit of a fire or something on the back of the right rear, and the AMR team's on board, on the scene. Check him out.
Window net coming down. And they will check him out. He'll head to the infield care center. A lot of hard hits this season. And another one here for Tyler Reddick. It's good to see him climb out.
So you see right side of the screen. practice gets loose. I mean, it's so strange to see these guys lose the side force and not be able to really collect the car. Contact hard with the inside wall, really hard. That bend in the wall is for the access for the vehicles, as you see it on the right side of the screen.
Yeah, they try to do away with those bends in the walls everywhere they can.
Yeah. And,
you know, and
so the back of these cars, they, you know, with this new next gen, they straightened and moved the rear tailpiece over a little bit so it's symmetrical left and right side. On the trucks, the Xfinity cars, and all the old Cup cars, that right side was straight as a board and provided a lot of side force. When these cars go into y'all and run against the fence, it gives you a lot more security. These cars do not have that. So once you get beyond a certain point of y'all, the spin is unsavable and you lose all of the side force. The car comes around quickly.
So cars on their way to pit road with race leader Mark Trex Jr. in front, Kim.
And we'll follow the stops first. Ross Chastain.
Oh, a hit. He got hit coming into his pit stall.
And you see him turned around. Absolute detriment to this team who had led. They wanted a little more on fire off, but Mark Trex Jr. not what they needed here late in the race, Marty.
Boy, pit road has been crazy today, Kim. Denny Hamlin said, I cannot get off the corner, especially turn four, two free on exit. Kyle Larson with a quick stop by the five bunch. You can tell by the confidence in Larson's voice, he was going to get Martin Truex Jr., but with the Truex spin on pit road, Larson gains a spot here, Rick.
And Rick, you called it live. It was definitely off the bumper of the five. I don't know if Truex checked up more in the speed lane. See, he kind of is slowing down, obviously, in front of the five. The five can't speed up. He'd be speeding on pit road. So, drivers, what's the etiquette? Do you normally blend left earlier than you check up? I mean, it seems like an odd kind of stack. And then right here, great work by the pit crew. You see the jack get hit. So thankful this pit crew was heads up and had an escape plan. Very dangerous situation for the 19.
Yeah, I mean, great response by those guys, seeing it coming, jumping back over wall. That's the main thing. Nobody got hurt. That was really scary looking. But let's listen to what Kyle Larson was talking about.
Did I spin the 19?
He did, but he was going to miss his stall. He didn't turn it.
Yeah, I thought he locked the brakes up in front of me, so I hope he's not mad at me.
Yeah, so that's what I'm looking at. The 19 car didn't turn and blend toward the stall like he typically would, as if he might have realized that he was actually going by the stall. You would never really turn in that late, so I wonder if Martin actually drove up on the stall, almost missing it, and notice this or realize this at the very last minute. Slows down really quickly. The 5, he can't do anything about it. Ends up turning him around.
And I have to ask myself, as the sun starts to set, you know, you're driving down pit road, looking into the sun, looking for your pit stall. Just wonder if he kind of lost track of where he was. Because I'm with you, Junior. You're like, see all the other cars, like the one. You kind of blend left and then turn in. The 19, when he does get spun, I'm not sure he would have made the pit stall.
Anyway.
There's no way he would have made it into his own pit stall.
Right. I think he's actually maybe missed his pit stall, just about missed it, and recognized it at the last second.
And if you're Larson, it's your job to be right on the rear bumper of that car in front of you. Watch the rear tires on the 19 car. Because you heard Larson say he thought he locked his tires up.
See, Martin, kind of the steering in Martin's car, though, is really subtle. It's not like a freak, you know, reaction to missing your. I'm thinking Martin, maybe Martin turned in there thinking everything's okay. But it was just, you know, Martin wanted to do a 90-degree turn into the stall, and you need to blend a little sooner so you don't get run over, Marty.
Yeah, Cliff Daniels continuing to coach his driver, Kyle Larson. He said, no doubt, he hit the brakes in front of me. And Cliff Daniels saying he would have gone 2 to 3 stalls past his own stall. There was no way he was going to make his stall. So trying to calm his driver down a little bit and reassure him, hey, that was just a mistake on their part, not your part.
Yeah, I just need to hear what this 19 team's opinion is about the whole event.
We're seeing Coach Joe Gibbs there, team owner, and a frown on his face. Doesn't look happy about what just took place.
It was definitely a freak situation. Nothing we have seen very often. Thank goodness for how dangerous it is. But definitely seems like a stack up of events. I'm not sure there was any ill intent on the 5. Kim, what are you hearing?
Yeah, I checked in with the team. I didn't hear anything on the radio from Martin in terms of not seeing his sign or his box. And so I asked, and they point blank said, no, the 5 spun us. So no indication from the 19 team that they feel like they were going to miss their box to despite how far out they were from the pit stalls. They think it was truly the five spinning mark.
Wow. Well, there you go. That's the 19. They have every right to their opinion. I'm not sure if I see it exactly that way, but such is competition.
And remember, the rule is you can drive through two pit stalls before you go into your pit stall, but you can't drive through three. So normally drivers will be already in a pit stall that is in front of theirs. And Martin Truex Jr. was almost beside the pit stall that he was trying to get into when he got hit.
Without a doubt, he's way far deep into the pit stall before he started to turn in. I'm just looking at Martin's steering wheel. There was no sort of "oh no" reaction. You know, his steering wheel was very subtle to turn in, so maybe in his opinion he was going to be fine. He certainly turned in really late, and you would want to fade left to get yourself out of any situation where the five might hit you. And you know if you got those guys on your bumper, you cannot slow down your pace in lane in front of them and expect not to get hit.
So Martin Truex Jr. now shuffles back out in 19th as they get ready for the choose. And Larson will restart on the outside of now Denny Hamlin, who will make up row one. It will be 17 laps of racing to go to find out, can Denny Hamlin secure a spot with a win here?
And this has put Martin Truex Jr. all the way back in 19th place. That little incident on pit road.
All right, so now we got the front row. Denny Hamlin, Kyle Larson. All day long, Denny Hamlin was complaining about his car. "My car will not take off." We saw them make it better. Kyle Larson, he's had the fastest car all day. Now he has clean air. So it's Kyle Larson's job just to get a great launch right here.
All right, so we've been judging how the 19 was getting the pit stall. Let's watch the 1 of Ross Chastain. Same idea, not the 11's just as close. Watch Ross. He's going to blend left and then decel. He pulls out of the fast lane at pit road speed. He doesn't allow the 11 to catch him in the rear bumper. That is what is normal to me. The 19, whether it was a mistake not seeing it or maybe it was on purpose and thought the 5 would have to check up, I don't know. The fact is, that did not look like the 1 at all. That entry for the 19 car looks much different than what is expected, and obviously much different than the 5 expected.
The other thing this did is a lot of people stayed out. Now there's 24 cars in the lead lap. So if you're a point guy and you don't finish this race off, if you have trouble, that caution right there could have a huge bearing on how many points you earn at the end of this day.
17 laps to go. Larson, a dominant day. Can he finish it off? Hamlin, Chastain. 2 playoff drivers looking for that automatic bid in the championship 4.
Dillon going to the inside. The 11 blocks.
While the 11 was blocking, the 5 surging ahead. Larson out front now.
Chastain on the outside of Hamlin. Hamlin gave him room. Look at Austin Dillon making it 3 wide, 2 wide onto the bottom. Brad Keselowski following him.
Larson dove to the bottom of the racetrack now, drifting up almost into the 11. Harvick trying that dive move also, all the way to the white line. He tries to get by the 1 of Ross Chastain.
We got some action back there. Cars moving around right side of your screen. Little contact. Hey, Jay, here it is right here. 22, 34, couple cars making contact back there off of turn 2. AJ making a few spots right there, diving to the inside. Passes the 4 into 3 and turns 3 and 4.
And William Byron having all kinds of issues. He's all the way back to 18th.
And with that, below the cut line now for the championship 4 in the playoffs. Chastain, Elliott, Hamlin, all above that cut line. Byron, Blaney, Bell, and Briscoe below.
Allmendinger for 3rd right here. Again, the colleague car with great fire-off speed. He needs to get these spots while he can. He'll be clear.
Allmendinger now up to 3rd. Pressure coming from the 1, Ross Chastain.
Dillon back there driving into the picture in that 3 car. Great run by him today.
Yeah, he's run well all day.
Here comes Dinger.
Wow,
he goes to the inside of the 11 of Hamlin for 2nd.
Hamlin had some kind of issue in turns 1 and 2. Lost a lot of pace. Oh, he's got that 1 car right in his door. He's got to get out of the gas.
The history between these two. Every time you see him close racing, you wonder when it's going to rear its head.
13 to go.
And the future history between these two, the 16 and the 1, I think next year they're going to be getting into it if they run like this every week.
Listen, Allmendinger was faster than Larson that lap.
I'm telling you, this car's been amazing in the first 5-10 laps. He's going to dive the inside here. One car, too, with great speed right now. Larson better pick it up. Get ready.
Yeah, his crew chief's going to say, just continue to do what you're doing. You'll pull away from him.
Chastain in that one car dives to the inside here, going to take that position away. What does he have for this five car in the final few laps of this race? They are right there. Larson's not going anywhere. Look how close they are. They actually pass each other, racing each other, and are driving up to the back bumper of this five car.
We saw Chastain last week, how close he got to winning that race. Drove very smart. Will he do the same thing today? He knows if he wins this race, he will go to Phoenix with a shot to win a championship.
What might have they done to the air pressure, the tires, or something in these two cars that are in second and third place to give them this pace? How long will that pace last? Will it be enough to go challenge for the lead?
What a season for Trackhouse Racing with Ross Chastain and Suarez both getting their first win this year. Then Ross Chastain, a second win, and now a possibility of making it to the championship four.
Truex has drove all the way up to ninth place. Update on him, driving mad through the field. There he is in that 19 car.
Allmendinger to the inside once again. Now Allmendinger trying to take second away from Larson.
Now I think if these two guys battle, they're starting to fade a little bit.
I don't know if they're fading or if the tires are finally old enough that that top for the five is really coming to life.
Yeah, that's the key right there. We've seen every run. Larson will flip that switch and drive away. Also, while we're out watching this great battle, William Byron's got back to 15th. Blaney has fallen back to 16th.
And the points have Hamlin and Byron tied right now. Byron now up a spot.
Chase Elliott in 13th. He's only plus 10 above the cut line. Such a huge, the 16 in the wall right there. What a race between these two. Look at him.
He comes all the way down the racetrack to try to side draft Chastain. Chastain gets the car in front of him now. Clear in second.
Go back and get him, AJ. Come on. This is fun.
He's going to try. AJ Allmendinger is going to be fun to watch next year, running a full time in this car.
Up into the wall. Ross Chastain. Will Allmendinger take advantage of it? He gets to the back bumper again for second. Seven laps to go in Miami.
Fastest car in the field, Martin Truex Jr. back in seventh. You said driving angry. It's to a new level.
Yeah.
Well, they found every way to not win a race this year.
Look at these two back here. AJ's like, I don't care if you're a playoff driver.
A little bit lower down the racetrack, taking a little bit of that air away from the 16 of Allmendinger.
Oh, Allmendinger's getting all there is in that car.
What an incredible job, a colleague.
Colleague Racing fielding the 16 for AJ Allmendinger. He will run full time next year for that organization. In the Cup Series, he's fighting for an Xfinity Series championship right now with colleague as well. Ross Chastain, a Florida native. Up into the wall again. Five laps remaining.
And unlike most tracks, Rick, what makes this track so special is there are not five simple laps. They might be running away from the wall down here in one and two, but down at three and four, even Kyle Larson leading, even with a 1-second lead, that is one little bit of entry speed, a little back to the throttle too hard. Look how close he is to the wall. You could lose a second with one simple mistake.
All the way up against the wall. It'll be four laps to go.
Hamlin
across
the wall.
The stripe. Denny Hamlin.
Really slow. He's going to lose a couple spots down this front straightaway to the six of Brad Keselowski and his teammate Truex.
He got the wall off turn four. Had to come all the way out of the gas.
Well, look what it does to the points, guys, right? He went from zero basically to minus four, minus three between him and Byron. Let's take a look.
Yeah, watch these cars passing as he's in the wall. And see, he got in the wall and he couldn't get away from it. And now all these guys going by him, 1 point, 2 points. We've seen so many times.
Oh, the 19 slowing down a little bit off of four. He's driving through the field. Gets by his teammate now. Looks like he might be giving up a spot.
Under three laps to go. The gap now, 1.3 seconds from Larson to Chastain.
Oh, Hamlin's got to squeeze up.
Truex fights back.
Hamlin cannot clear the 19.
Maybe Truex had an issue in three and four. I wasn't sure what was going on, but it looks like he's not going to give that position up if he doesn't have to.
They continue to fight. And second, still held by Ross Chastain. But here comes the 16. Allmendinger looking to the inside one more time.
1.5 now. 1.5, they're pointed right with you.
Former teammates on the top of the screen in the Xfinity Series and teammates on the bottom of the screen for Joe Gibbs Racing. As the five comes off turn four, and it's one lap to go, presented by Credit One Bank. Kyle Larson has led 198 laps today. He will lead 199 if he can close it out. He goes all the way to the bottom of the racetrack through one and two. As dominant as a car as Kyle Larson has been at this racetrack so many times, his best finish has been second. That is until today. Kyle Larson comes off turn four. And Larson will win at Homestead, Miami. A dominant performance. Cliff Daniels getting a hug from Jeff Gordon there. And the big boss, Mr. H. You think back to the Roval and Kyle Larson, a mistake.
I am so happy for you, Kyle. So happy for you. Happy for this team, guys. Resilient. It's not been the prettiest of years for us. One stage two, won the race. Great execution. Great job all day. So proud of you guys. So proud of this team.
What a season it would have been. Kyle Larson eliminated from the playoffs after the round of 12. But he comes right back here, the second race of the round of eight, and wins convincingly here, leading 199 laps.
He had to work for it in that final stage, Rick. Some guys brought a little more pace there right at the end, a late yellow as well, and a battle on that final restart.
This checkered flag moment brought to you by Advance Auto Parts. There's been quite a few of these moments. For the 30-year-old out of Elk Grove, California, 19 career wins now with this one. A champion a year ago, after winning the final race of the season at Phoenix, and looking like he was the favorite for the championship in 2022, but too many mistakes took him out of the playoff contention after the round of 12. But like every great racer, the ultimate goal is to get back to victory lane, and Larson has been able to do that.
A-plus burnout. Whole length of the front straightaway. He's happy about this win, guys.
It was a difficult race in Vegas last week. Remember, he drifted up the racetrack, squeezed the 45 of Bubba Wallace into the wall. Wallace came back down, retaliated, took him out. And now he's rebounded and will be heading to victory lane. He's at the start-finish line, and Marty's there with him.
Boy, Rick, what a week for Kyle Larson. In the middle of the controversy last week, taken out at Las Vegas. But today, man, did he deliver. Led all but 68 laps. And for the Miami fans, he finally gets a win at one of his best racetracks here at Homestead Miami Speedway. So, Kyle, going to go get the checkered flag first. Celebrate with the fans for a moment. I know this is one you wanted bad. Is this sort of reminiscent of last year when you guys were so dominant, Kyle? Maybe the best run you guys have had all year long.
Yeah, definitely the best run we've had all year long. We've been capable of it. I feel like many weekends we just haven't quite put it all together. So Cliff gave a great speech this morning and got us all ready to go and focused and did my best to keep it out of the wall. I got in the wall a few times, but I could still make speed doing that. So. Amazing race car. I knew that last run was going to be short enough where I was going to be in some sort of trouble there, but thankfully AJ and Ross were racing hard behind me. So huge thanks to Valvoline, HendrickCars.com, everybody at Hendrick Motorsports too. I think it was a good day for Chase and William. But yeah, happy for our team. And we get to go race for an owner's title in Phoenix in a couple weeks. So we're still technically not out of it. I know I can't win the championship, but it means more to me to win it as a team. So we're going to go to Phoenix and try and get another championship.
I have to ask you about the contact on pit road with Martin Truex Jr. What was your view of what happened?
Yeah, so I was just going behind him, and he hung a hard left and was hard on the brakes at the same time, and I ran right in the back of him. So I don't know if my team said he was late, turned into a stall, but I don't know if it was my fault. I'm sorry. I don't think it was, but it's hard to see down this pit road. I don't know if fans and people realize when you got debris all over your windshield, the sun's shining straight in your face, it's hard to see your stall. So hate that happened. He was definitely the one that I was going to have to beat. He was really good that last long run too. So what a fun day. I've always wanted to race here during the day at Homestead. We could rip the wall and finally have a car tough enough for me to be able to run the wall and finish the race. So a lot of fun today. Hope you fans enjoyed the ass kicking there, and hope we can do it again in a couple weeks.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. said it was an A-plus burnout. I would say it was an A-plus day overall for Kyle Larson and Hendrick Motorsports, Kim.
Well, let's get Martin Truex Jr.'s side of the story. We saw the contact from the 5, checked in with your team. They said the 5 spun you. Larson just told Marty he didn't think it was his fault. The booth noted you seemed a little far to commit to your pit stall. What happened?
Yeah, it was definitely a little bit of both of that. It's really hard to see through these windshields right now with the sun like that and all the stuff covering it. And I did see my box late for sure. And so I slowed down before I turned out of the way the 5 there. So obviously partly on me. I didn't expect to get turned around. I'm glad nobody got hurt there. But overall it's just disappointing. And to have a good day going like that and have a shot at winning and, couldn't close the deal. So I hate it for my team. It's been one of those years, So thanks to Best Pro and Johnny and Tracker and Cabela's, everybody that supports us and sticks behind us, all our fans. We're going to keep digging. We're going to win a bunch of races. We just got to get through this rough patch.
Whether it was a mistake or just bad luck, another win, losing from Martin Truex Jr. and this team.
Yeah, rough patch, Kim. He's talked about it. He's lived it here this season. But it's Larson heading to the Ruoff victory lane. Second race of the round of 8, and Ross Chastain, Chase Elliott, and William Byron will leave Miami above the cut line with only one race remaining to determine who will make it into the championship four. Joey Logano, with his win a week ago at Vegas, he's locked into that championship four. And Kyle Larson, A huge win here for that organization. 199 laps led. More NASCAR coverage always available on NBCSports.com. Coming up next on NBC Local News, except on the West Coast. And later, it's Sunday Night Football. The Steelers, Dolphins. Congratulations. Kyle Larson winning at Miami.